Welcome, my friends. Welcome. Here we are on the Monday Global Transmission, the 16th day of May. There is so much that we're obviously going to be going over today as we accelerate into open world government and the technocrats' attempt to dominate the planet and humanity. We have Robert Tosh Plumley, the famous CIA whistleblower, who helped first expose specifically what happened in Benghazi, joining us, tying it into Fast and Furious and the connections to Al-Qaeda, ISIS, El Chapo, and the gun running. And we have the Marine Corps colonel, recently retired, Matt Smithmeck, who has been physically attacked, threatened, you name it, for investigating Fast and Furious out of Arizona and the military base that he was stationed at. He'll be joining us also with Kent Terry, brother of Brian Terry, for the latest huge developments on this front in the second hour and how it all ties together with the criminal networks that have seized control of this nation. David Knight will be hosting the fourth hour. All right. People say, why do you do it that way? Where you have a four-hour radio show, you host 3 hours, and then you have your anchors and people come into the fourth hour. Well, because that's how I do things. I do things different than other radio networks, other people. And we've trailblazed a lot of things and innovated a lot of stuff. And I think it's good to have a new horse come in 3 hours in with all the stuff that's breaking and all that's going on, to have a whole other hour of high energy analysis, special reports, guests, and more. That's why we're doing it. Stations love it. We appreciate all the affiliates. They're starting to pick up the fourth hour. As the years go on here, if we're able to, we want to add more and more hours. Until, you know, we've got maybe 6, 7, 8, 9 hours of live broadcast today. We've got the nightly news as well, 7 o'clock Central. So that's basically the goal there. Now, in the first hour, I say this every broadcast, and I rarely actually do what I want to do, but I've just somehow got to cover all this news, most of it in the first hour, at least get into a lot of it. We come back from break, we'll get into it. RNC chairman warns against suicide third-party run against Trump. I covered it yesterday, but I forgot to ask you guys. Will you reprint me the New York Times big story Friday? Oh, my gosh. He asked women out after he was married, when he was divorced. And he would come forward in a restaurant and tell a woman she was beautiful. It's so male. It's so evil. Now, Bill Clinton flying around on jets with pedophile masters on the Lolita Express, Mr. Epstein, flying him to this pervert island. On Fantasy Island with Mr. Montalban, but no, Pedophile Island. That's not in the New York Times, but it's all over the other news that Bill Clinton flew on the plane many more times than previously known. So you guys, please print me that one also the New York Times, because I want to go over some of this because it's just a perfect example of manipulation. Did you hear? Dun, dun, dun. Washington Post, New York Times, LA Times, all reporting. Oh, my gosh. He dated women, and sometimes he'd ask women out. And he had one girl, Freddie told, was gaining a little too much weight. She was depressed. Then she was on Fox News this morning when I was working out, saying, I didn't even say that to the New York Times. They just kept asking her, did he do anything mean? Was he ever rude? She's like, well, yeah, once he kind of said I should probably want to lose a little bit of weight. And it, you know, kind of made me work on it a little bit. But, oh, my gosh. He told his girlfriend she was getting a little fat. Thank God I've had family tell me, you know, 6, 7 years ago, buddy, you're really big now. You need to work out more and lose some weight and stop eating Bluebell ice cream at 10 o'clock at night every night. You know what? I did that. And I've lost close to 70 pounds. And I'm still going down slowly now. So this is the nanny state. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. He told her girlfriend she was gaining weight. Oh, my God. Oh, now, if you got like 10-year-old girls in rape camps with the president, you know, kidnapped on rape planes, that's all. Come on. That's all right. But, man, Donald Trump. Whoa. I mean, this guy is a monster. Can you say hashtag monster? Oh, my gosh. All right, where to start? Infowars.com is the website. I'm Alex Jones, your host. We're going to tie Fast and Furious in with the El Chapo, CIA, ISIS, Al-Qaeda connection with a Marine Corps colonel who's been investigating it with Brian Terry's brother and, of course, with the famous CIA whistleblower, Tosh Plumley, coming up in the second hour. The third hour will be open phones and analysis, as will be the first hour. Let me just run over these headlines for you, as I always attempt to do, but today it's going to happen. Let me just start here. Crossing the line, how Donald Trump behaved with women in private. And it says that he walked up and would ask attractive women when he was not married if they'd like to date him. And that once he told a girlfriend she was gaining weight. Turns out that's not even true. My gosh, this is just stunning. This man is just of pure evil. Pontius Pilate would say, I find great sin in this man. Crossing the line, but then I have a stack of articles here. Woman in New York Times piece about Trump treatment of women says she was misquoted. The girlfriend. Oh. Bill Clinton was frequent flyer on pedophile's private jet, Lolita Express. Jeffrey Epstein. And of course, he'd been lying about that, going to the private pedo island, but it's all coming out. But, you know, that's not a big story. Donald Trump asked attractive women out at cocktail parties as if the women weren't there to be asked out. And then they said yes. What a horrible person, like asking 30-year-old bombshell women out on dates. That is just so abnormal. It is. It's a powerful alpha male that likes full-grown women. No, 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 no. 10-year-old girl at a pedo island with Bill Clinton? That's okay. Bill Clinton settling all the rape cases? A-okay. I'm going to get a little bit more into that a little for you. Because I'm a hate monger. That's what the media says. Yeah. George Clooney said so. George Clooney. We're talking about him a little bit later. RNC chairman warns against suicide third-party run. That's Priebus while he creeps around behind the scenes helping set it up with Mr. Crystal, the heir to the Trotskyites from Russia. Seriously, from Russia, can't make it up, Trotskyites. Boy, that's wonderful. RNC chairman warns against suicide third party. Washington insiders planning third party campaign to steal presidency from Trump. That's a David Horowitz article. That's our headline. We changed it for InfoWars. On Breitbart, it's Bill Crystal, Republican spoiler, renegade Jew. Continuing, Zuckerberg, oh, this is just special, isn't it? Zuckerberg, that calls his users dumb effers, to meet with Beck and former Bush official Perino, or Perina, as I call her. So Zuckerberg, to meet with Beck and Perina, will ignore Drudge and InfoWars, who actually got listed in some of the blacklisting, Drudge especially, but we were listed in a few, that we should be blocked in the algorithm, as if I needed whistleblowers to go public to tell me that. We already could see how that would happen. Everybody else gets to share their videos. You can't post our videos on your video wall or on your Facebook when they block them. Sometimes they don't. When they don't block us, we get 2 million views. When they do, we get 50,000. And it's exactly what we've been saying is happening with the whistleblowers going public. But I want to thank the whistleblowers for going public. And they specifically were saying block Drudge. Don't people put his name, his links in. Now, Drudge is right. He says, well, just don't go to Facebook. That's what should happen. People should leave it. It should fall apart because it's a fraud. But until the public figures that out, we go on Facebook to operate the First Amendment, to reach out to people and to let them know what's going on, to light a flare, to call in the air support, which is Congress and Drudge and everybody else. We're just putting flares on target. We're lasing the target so the smart bombs can come in and stop the censorship and blast the dam out of the way. So it's different approaches. I don't think anybody's wrong. I think all these approaches together are going to expose this. But Glenn Beck's going to go and meet with Zuckerberg and the former White House press secretary. That's how they're going to, that's who represents conservatives. That's who Zuckerberg wants to meet with, is Beck and the White House official that would get up there and tell us there was no drone program. Oh, that was going on under Bush, too, and would tell us that the dollar being devaluated wasn't devaluing the dollar, and just incredible bull. Not as bad as Obama's press secretary, you know, saying there, we never said there wouldn't be boots on the ground. Obama never said that as a conspiracy theory. He said it 16 times in press conferences in Syria. I'm not even going to play the clip of him saying it and then show when they said they didn't say it. It's just these are mega whoppers. Whoppers. And they do it because they think you're dumb. Just like the New York Times was, dun, 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 dun. Ladies and gentlemen, we're dropping a bombshell later Friday that may bring down Donald Trump. Drum roll, please. A huge cover page report, the whole front of their website, the whole front of the paper. 12 pages long. Donald Trump asked women out for dates And again, that's the great crime. Just like Seinfeld's daughter's like, we're going to move back to New York, honey. We're out in the country so you can meet more boys now that you're 14. Daddy, boys and girls together, sexes don't say boy or girl. He's like, my daughter's really ignorant. No, your daughter has been programmed, bro. Don't say soup Nazi. Oh, you're making light of Hitler now with your soup Nazi. No, it's hilarious calling the guy a soup Nazi. It's hilarious with a guy with his pug heiling Hitler. Charlie Chaplin's hilarious. John Cleese is hilarious. You people are control freaks who get off on telling people how to talk and what to do. And I, for one, have had enough of it, but I'm digressing. Glenn Beck, oh, he's so proud. He will go with his little pudgy fake face and the famous liberal 30 years on radio, the most pro-abortion, anti-gun savage. Let me tell you don't change like that. And then suddenly he's your leader. He'll lead you. And he's going to prance over to Zuckerberg. Bang, 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 bang. And then he'll come out and represent and he'll get the traffic. And Beck admits, I'm not getting a lot of traffic. Maybe Zuckerberg will promote me. That's his reward. And now Beck will be a star again. And everyone will love him and love his little poor acting skills, and he'll ninny and nanny and candy butt around. Candy butt, Glenn Beck. I mean, it's just sick. I'm not against guys that are candy asses. It's just that he acts like he's a tough guy, and he's not. And I've had enough. So we got that article. Kit Daniels up on Infowars.com. Oh, I'm four stories into one stack. Sorry, there's only about 200 articles here. Whiteness history speaker, whites owe blacks $20 trillion in reparations. There's video of that, Infowars.com. Fury, oh, let's put this on screen, please. It's up on Infowars.com. Fury at racist cartoon comparing Butch and masculine Michelle Obama to pregnant, ready Melania Trump. Pageant ready. I'm having a Freudian slip. Now, let me go ahead and show you this. This is the two ladies. And we've had doctors on about this. Her shoulders are too wide. She's on like the 100th percentile of women, okay, with her body type. Her arms, everything. She always has this pooch, like she's wearing either a codpiece or has genitalia, okay? Now, she looks like a man. Like, dude looks like a lady. Lady looks like a dude. And this is a funny cartoonist, Ben Garrison, who they're always calling racist and bad. And, I mean, I'm sorry. It's true. It's a giant viral video phenomenon for like 8 years that she's a man. All I know is Obama was raised by a tranny in Indonesia. They're into all sorts of stuff. Hillary's daughters, Webster Hubbles, none of the stuff we're told by these people is true. And national media takes it when I talk about this and acts like I'm crazy. Listen, there's hundreds of millions of views on YouTube. There's some videos with like 10 million views apiece, and there's dozens and dozens of them. Probably more than 100 million. I'm just guesstimating. Dead reckoning. Where mainline liberal sites think she's a man. Okay? It's not racist to say she looks like a man. And let me explain something. Cartoonists famously make fun of everybody. There's cartoons everywhere making me look like I weigh 400 pounds. There's cartoons with me with big nose and all this stuff. That's what you do in editorial cartoons. It's been going on for 300 years. Everybody gets made fun of. Everybody gets bigger ears, bigger noses. Look at editorial cartoons of LBJ as a nose to the ground. Richard Nixon. This is what you do. You ran for office. You are the co-president that tells kids what lunch to eat around the country because you're God. Obama is obsessing, saying he'll sue Texas, sue North Carolina if we don't teach five-year-olds how to be trannies, trying to sexually confuse kids. And you're fair game. And don't forget the famous comedian Joan Rivers said, of course everyone knows she's a tranny. She's dead serious. Yeah, she's a man. Deader than a doornail in a routine operation where basically she had fire poured down her throat, was a fire-breathing goblin. Dead on arrival. Shoot your mouth off, honey. You will die. Liberal. Like Bono gets billions in huge concert deals, says it's all going to charity to AIDS Africa, and keeps 99% greediness. And George Clooney opened the borders up. He has $100 million chateaus, doesn't bring in one immigrant or whatever, and says Trump wants to hurt women because he says radical Muslims are a danger, when it's the radical Muslims totally enslaving over 500 million women. George Clooney, you maggot. I was going to show Drudge Report for TV viewers, but Drudge just changed it like 10 seconds ago. But look, now it's Obama International Order. Yeah, calling for this world government. TSA nightmare, 4,000 travelers miss flights after long, 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 long lines. Oh, and they're asking for more money now, magically. Even though their budget always gets bigger, more money. Give us some money, Lebowski. But this is what I wanted to show you. Anti-Trump conservatives in Facebook meetup. And that's what I was mentioning. We've got a story up on Infowars.com. This is from Breitbart. And there's Beck on his knees to Zuckerberg. That's right. They're being rewarded. They're going to represent for the investigation and be the stars. And they'll say it's okay that good conservatives get promoted, but not the nasty, meany ones like DrudgeReport.com or Infowars.com or WorldNet Daily or Breitbart or Daily Caller or any of those other meanies. I'm sorry, I've got other news to get into, but it was just some of the crew in there making the point that, hey, you know, there's all those videos where Obama keeps calling, well, Michael here, I mean, Michelle. Hey, Michael, I mean, Michelle, come on over here. I really think her daughters don't look like her. I really think this is some weird hoax they did again. It's like he didn't get sworn in on the Bible. It was the Quran, all this weirdness. I mean, I used to laugh at this stuff, but man, it's all about rubbing our noses in it. And I think it's all an arranged marriage. It's all completely fake. And it's this big, sick joke because he's obsessed with transgender. This is like some weird cult or something. I think Michelle Obama is a man. I really do. I really do. I believe it. Just like the minute I saw Frank Marshall Davis in his porno photos in Dreams of My Real Father and his and Obama writing a book that he lived with him in the summers and that it was his grandfather's best friend. And then I saw the photos of Obama's mother on the same couch as Obama's photographed on at Frank Marshall Davis's house, but with in a lesbian photo shoot. My mother didn't believe it when she heard the guest on like 3-4 years ago, and she wanted to see the DVD that we sell. And she saw it, and she said, it's incredible. It's true. It is. That's the whole Kenya thing. Why she kept saying he was born in Kenya, and when he was the head of the law review, he said he was born in Kenya. In his bio, for several years straight, in the law review, it said born in Kenya. And then we're like, look at this. You're born in Kenya. You say you weren't. Stop lying. Why all these fake birth certificates in 9 different layers? Day one, we pulled it up. It was in layers. It was fake. The typewriter printer stuff was a Microsoft Word. See, each strike of a typewriter is like a snowflake or a water droplet. It's different. There's never one the same. When it splats, there's micro splatters. We just blew up the letters, compared them. It was the same font. We even went to Microsoft and looked it up. It was fake, but it was meant to be. We're like, why is this so fake? Why is this to mess with us, to taunt us? No. See, there's CIA tactics and intelligence agency tactics that say, like, they'll go, you know, spray PCP or gas on a crowd and then run around in, like, you know, puppy dog outfits so no one really knows what happened and everybody's hallucinating and then several people are killed in the crowd in an assassination, but later no one even knows what went on. They tried that in, you know, Jacob's Ladder and stuff in Vietnam. They did tests like that. A lot of us declassified. They admit at Guantanamo Bay when they're torturing people, they just run around in devil outfits while they're on LSD and then have prostitutes come in who are menstruating to smear blood all over them just to totally whack them out. I mean, I don't want to get gross here, but this is the type of stuff they do. It's the same thing here. They have like a tranny up there as the first lady. His dad's a famous commie leader on the actual communist board running communist newspapers nationwide, funding the party with hardcore porn. Underground porn back then was big money. And it's just total black ops. His grandpa's CIA. And it's just freakazoid. It's total freakazoid. And they're mad that they have a man with a good-looking wife as president. They don't want that. They want to train you to submit and break your will. Just like it was declassified, the CIA puts out deviant art and deviant music to break society and to turn you all into jellyfish. When you go out in the general public, most people look like the walking dead, like their souls got sucked out of their eyeballs. All right, let me go ahead now and get back into the news. I think there's something going on with Michelle Obama. There are some chromosomal disorders where women can basically be hermaphroditic, but still have female genitalia. And you notice a lot of the top athletes now in the world that are women, whether it be in marathons or wrestling or powerlifting. It turns out some of those African women, some of those Russian women, some of those American women, you know, they've had DNA tests and they're guys. They're guys. And they've got those chromosomes. They've got that going on. And there's questions in the Olympic Committee and things about whether they're going to exclude these folks. And politically correct groups are saying, no, no, let them. Okay, well, they're a man, but they don't have the genitals. But they've got a man's genetics, a man's muscles, a man's bone structure, a man's speed. Let's just let then men have sex changes and you know, all the leaders, all the top swimmers, all the top boxers, all the top basketball players, it's going to be men. I mean, men will then dominate women's sports. You can say, oh, well, those are women. I can just self-identify as whoever I want. I mean, I'm sorry, Wilt Chamberlain at 6'9" or whatever, 6'10", couldn't identify as a woman. He was a man and a man's man. And you could remove his testicles or have him, you know, with one testicle like Lance Armstrong, to get scientific here, and he would still dominate any woman in his prime on the basketball court, period, because he's a man. Oh, I identify as a blind person. The state's going to pay for me to pour Drano in my eyes and then pay for me to be at home on welfare. You're a freak. You need to be in a mental institution. And I'm sure not paying for it. Now, are there people that really feel like they're a woman and were brought up like that? Absolutely. I've read the science. There's actually scientific times where a man has genetics and there's different variants and different, you know, double Y, double X's, where you really are pretty much a woman, but you've got a member. It's the same way. So there is cases where this goes on. It goes on in the entire mammal kingdom. So there's that argument, well, this is natural. I was born this way. In a minority of cases, it is that way. And I want to explain something. I don't dislike anybody. I really don't care if you're a man and think you're a woman or you're a woman and think you're a man. Just here's the deal. There's a globalist agenda to push this, to sexually confuse children, and then to have a lobbying groups come in and get 5, 6, 7, 8-year-olds to decide they want a sex change, and then the state's coming in and doing it in areas of Europe and trying to do it with 10-year-olds and are doing it with 11-year-olds despite what parents want in the U.S. And, man, that's crazy. If the school can't take your children to the zoo without them signing a form, why can they take them for an abortion in many states or to have a sex change? This is the state coming in and dominating and using a new social right, a new civil right, a new human right to inject this. And they know we're a liberal, altruistic, open society. We're like, okay, sure. And then next it's, we're going to teach your kids how to do this. No, you're not. No, you're not. And when I say Michelle Obama looks like a man, folks, she looks like a man. Lady looks like a dude. And so regardless, they're calling it racist and saying it should be taken down. That is totally and completely protected what Ben Garrison's doing. I'll get Ben Garrison on the show. Can we document cam that for TV viewers and show it to him again? Now, before I go any further, the story's up on Infowars.com. We found three of these, but they're not edited together yet, so I'm not going to play all three of them in a row, but I'm going to do this later and put a special report out with this. We found in just the last few minutes three different times that Obama, at military commencement speeches and at high school and college commencements, is there with Michelle Obama and says, Michael and I. And you don't get your wife's name wrong and then call it a male name. It's like if you're married to Christina, you don't say, Chris and I have been married. No, you say, Christina and I. You don't mess up a name, and you don't do it three times that we just found in a few minutes, and there are, in article reports, dozens of times. And, you know, maybe that's because Chris wears the pants in the family. That's reportedly from all of Obama's boyfriends that Wayne Madsen looked to into Chicago. Obama, you know, is the girl. He's the catcher, not the pitcher. And so, you know, that's probably why, you know, it's the whole Butch thing going, is because that's daddy right there. So, that's the report on that front. Just thought everybody would know about that. Gold Depository could soon be on its way to Tejas. We're going to get into that. DNC boss is Clinton. Not under investigation by FBI, though they say they are. Just total lies, total disinformation from a pack of liars. We're also going to get into Obama doesn't think rapist, armed robbers, and drug dealers are criminals. They're officially trying to change the name of that. Also, we're going to get into U.S. concern grows over possible Venezuela meltdown officials. We told you years ago it's melting down. We told you last month it's melting down. And I actually saw articles attacking me saying Jones is fear-mongering, saying Venezuela's melting down. Well, it is melting down. Giant riots, murders, death in the streets. We've got a story up on drudgereport.com, originally from zerohedge.com. Scenes from the Venezuelan apocalypse. Countless wounded after 5,000 loot supermarket looking for food. As pure desperation has set in, crime has become inevitable. They might even get more crime-ridden than Mexico. So that footage is up on Infowars.com. We're going to cover that. But first, since we mentioned it, again, this report is up on DrudgeReport.com. TSA nightmare. And by the way, I just want to say to all of our great crew, even our board ops and camera people, if you want me to get you a phone that's got good digital video, I just thought of this, please, when you're out, be a reporter, shoot video of this stuff, because we've got video, but Allie was there in Chicago, 4+ hours stuck. One of our great news researchers and TV control room switchers, and she was stuck in this for 4 hours. And boy, I just always remind my crew videotape stuff. But we've got other folks that videotaped it. Remember last week there were 3-4 hour lines that were up to a mile long. TSA nightmare, 4,000 travelers miss flights after long, 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 long lines. And we need somebody to write a big article about this. We're about to talk to her. Because does anybody remember when Drudge and I and others pushed that national opt-out holiday? And we were doing articles almost every day for about a year, about 5 years ago. And then when we said opt-out for the week of Thanksgiving, one of the busiest flight days of the year, probably the busiest. Do you remember what happened? For a full week, they just turned the stinking machines off. The border's wide open. They fly people in from Pakistan, from Afghanistan, from Syria, and Saudi Arabia. Don't even search them. That's in the news. So, of course, you could turn the scanners off. Of course, you could just wave us through and walk through the frickin' metal detector. But you want to train us to put your hands on our Michelle Obamas. You want to put your hands on the family Michelle Obamas. You want to get your hands on the Michelle, family jewel, Obama's goodies, and our wives and our daughters, and just train us. Just like top psychologists have said, the touching of children is training them to get the Sandusky, Bill Clinton, Epstein, pedo treatment. But that's okay. Donald Trump asked hot women out when he was married. I mean, after he was married. And he was married. He had kids. He was a man. He played golf. He ate hamburgers. He's confident. He swaggers around. He's a horrible person. Because the crime is that he's a man and women like him. So they want to get all the women going, he talked to women. He wants to get the ugly women vote. I don't see any women as ugly, but that, you know what it is? There's this new meme out that really hot chicks are putting out saying, hey, I want fourth wave feminism where mentally ill, uptight, ugly women don't hate on me all day because I'm good looking. I just think all women are great. Look at them. I love human beings, period. But I mean, there is a lot of social envy going on here. And nobody's meaner than women to super hot chicks. That's why super hot chicks, back before I was married and stuff, are the easiest to get a date with. Because most guys are intimidated by them. And women are messing with them. And when you're just charming and funny and talk to them, they just can't believe that somebody's being sweet to them. Okay, but let's go to Allie. Allie, I heard the whole story. She was telling me during the break. I guess she was on a trip. Tell us what you were doing, what happened in Chicago. You enjoyed this while you're talking. We'll also show some of the news articles and footage of this, because last week they were trying to deny there was even a problem, but then they went to Congress and shook them down so they get more money to set up checkpoints all over the highway. Then there'll be big highway lines. Then they'll need more money. The power to tax is the power to destroy. The power to block roads and transportation is called martial law. And so just like Venezuela and everywhere else, it's a tool of control. And so we're showing mega, massive, ultra-gigantor lines that look like they just go on for miles and miles. So, Allie, thank you so much. Tell us what you enjoyed there in Chicago. Which airport you were at more? Thank you.
Yeah, so I was in Chicago O'Hare, and yesterday, my flight was yesterday, actually. And I got there, and I just walked in, and I saw this immense line, and I knew right then and there, I was like, I'm missing this flight. Because it was an hour away and I was just not going to make it. And then you can see in the screen right now, like how long they were. It was incredible. It was going from one side of the airport to the other. And it like flipped three times even before you got in. People were like, I've been waiting in line for 2 hours, 3 hours. And then I went up and I was talked to some of the TSA people and be like, hey, I need to get on my flight. I have work tomorrow. I have to be at the show. And they didn't care. They were just like, well, it's not my problem. It's not my problem. I don't care. And they would just send me to the next person until they told me to I had to rebook.
Sure.
And that's
what I want to put a meme out here for folks. I want you to continue your story because this is the truth. No one's pointing out yet this is the hijacking of the country, demanding more money. We're being held captive and ransom our air flight systems. Europe's being flooded with 5 million people who they demand every country must accept to create chaos. France has declared for 2 months their highway system is, quote, in collapse with mass robberies every night, cars being carjacked. I mean, it's bedlam. People say, why are the governments doing this? Because they're going to get more power and control and all these new federal global highway police out of it. So this is what they're doing. It's the exact same plan here. Please continue with what happened to you. So they tell you they don't care. I mean, in your words, how are they acting? How long did this block you? When did you finally get a flight back to Taos?
I finally got a flight. I got standby today at 7 in the morning. So I had to, they told me, come in at 3:30 because that's when TSA opens. And I got I went to the airport at 4 in the morning and it was still packed. People had been staying there overnight. Cots were out and everything. And it took me an hour and a half that time to go through TSA. So I'm glad I went early because I would have missed that flight as well. But like when you got up to them, they were all like super happy and just like chill. And like they didn't care that there was a 4 hour line. And
that's because they're told to do it to get raises. It's a criminal organization. A third of their employees have been caught routinely stealing. They rob your prescription medicine. It's incredible.
Yeah. You didn't see them like feel bad for anybody. They were just like enjoying their job. And it was very like there was not enough people to work. They didn't even have bins. And then they brought in like a canine and they didn't even use him. Like they were just there and they didn't care about everybody. And it made me feel really mad because I was like,
you know what Mel Brooks says though? It's good to be the king. I'm sorry. You said it made you feel bad because you're a bad person.
I'm a nice person.
No, you're very nice. I mean, I'm being sarcastic.
Yeah.
So it made you feel bad to have them just so nonchalant?
Yeah, it's like, why are you being so nonchalant about something that shouldn't even be happening? Like, people should be moving. And then I read an article saying that they were blaming the people for not being ready.
Oh, I know. They said you're bad. I saw that article. TSA says the people are bad, even though they admit they're just standing down. Well, listen, it gets worse. Remember the ad they put in Seattle 2 years ago that said, we want you to be aggressive and imperious and rude. Imperious means arrogant and royal. And so they're telling him to just be royal. Total arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
There it is. News Channel 8, NBC, TSA blames you for longer lines at airport security checkpoints. And all you dumb socialists and people in MSNBC that love living under this, you're all going to be treated like slaves too, you morons. Sorry, ma'am. Go ahead.
No, that's okay. The funny thing is also like I talked to a bunch of people when I was there and the news was there and everything and everybody was reporting it. And this woman was like, oh yeah, I've been in line for 3 hours. And they were like, we're just going to have to rebook you. Oh wait, there's no flights. So a lot of people were just missing. She also told me that people that were inside the airport, they were like, the airplanes are empty because nobody's in here.
And of course, that's going to cause a chain reaction for days and days. So when was your flight? How long were you held up total? And when did you finally get out? This morning?
Yes, this morning. I actually just came straight from the airport. But the flight was last night at 8 p.m. I got there at 5, was in line for an hour and a half. And then they were like, well, you just have to rebook. So went back to my family who is in Chicago, stayed the night, went back at 3 in the morning and waited an hour and a half just to get into TSA.
Was that your mom's place up in Chicago?
Actually, my cousin.
Your mom is really nice. I've met her before.
Yeah, she was there too.
You look just like her. Well, listen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. All of you guys, do you have a phone that has video?
Yes, I do. I actually took some footage. That's the footage you were seeing.
See, folks, there's no teleprompters. There's no planning here because there's so much news. We're moving so fast. I mean, I got ready for hours this morning at home, but I hadn't talked to her, so I'm chastising, saying, where's the footage? And it's on the camera. Okay, she gets a bonus. Great job. And anybody else in this crew? Because we got company phones. People say, well, I didn't bring a camera because I thought company phones stay at the office. No, the company phones go with you. And anyone that works for me that wants a phone that doesn't have one with a video camera or wants a camera, I will get you one because everybody's a reporter in this operation and every citizen listening and watching is a reporter. And Allie, you're already getting a bonus for the great job you've done. You're getting a bigger one. Great job.
Thank you so much.
Wow, so that's her footage. We need to put InfoWars on that. Man, I get so upset because I see it. I know what it is. And it's come out in other federal agencies where they'll hold up bridges and hold up dams and hold up electricity and hold up drawbridges and go, the drawbridges are now closed at 9 at night when they used to be open to get more funds. It's a famous memos that have come out in different cities. In fact, Chicago 20 years ago, where they would hold up potholes until they got more money. And I mean, the city of Austin has billions in slush funds. They're always claiming they don't have enough money. And the property taxes are the highest in the state here. And of course, it's going on in your town too. Mind blowing. Well, good job, Allie. We should interview her on the nightly news tonight and point out our great, you know, board op slash researcher that got some great footage, and we should put a whole report out on that. So there you go, folks. I'm like, you need to have a video camera. Well, she did. That's called going off half-cocked. But hey, it's better to be early than late, right? Early bird gets the worm. So fantastic, fantastic crew. Okay, where to start here on that whole front? You know, I've got like dozens of stories I haven't even mentioned yet and stuff I want to go back into. But this whole thing with Zuckerberg meeting with another guy that thinks his listeners are dumb effers, and that's Glenn Beck. I mean, you talk about face in the crowd, baby. He's the real deal. I haven't seen that movie. It's excellent. 1950s or 60s movie with Andy Griffith. Starring Andy Griffith. Now, can we pull up the IMDb on face in the crowd? You've got to see it, folks, if you want to know the type of true dirt bags we're dealing with here. And I'm sorry, it's just a fact. Look at this. TSA breakdown. Airport lines go for hours. Drudge just updated again. And this goes to a Chicago CBS local. We've got to get a report out with Allie immediately. You know, eyewitness, you know, talks about the arrogance of the TSA. There's your headline. And then just have her maybe be interviewed by Leanne right now over in the other studio and just bang her video out immediately without all my hyperbole. And I think we'll probably see it up on the vaunted king of media, drudgereport.com. Nightmarish lines continue at airport security checkpoints. Nightmarish. There's no need to fear, though. I'm sure they'll just give them double funding, and then no one will remember a few years from now when they pull the same trick again. But remember, you have the Trump card. Wait a minute. You're leaving the borders wide open. You're shipping people in with no coverage. Hey, you're letting them not even, you know, have their IDs looked at. And wait a minute, you got rid of the lines completely when we said boycott and opt out to shut down the lines ourselves. But see, they weren't ready to do a funding boost then, so we were going to shut it down like a national strike to have the airlines pressure them. Because the pilots had already said no and wouldn't be checked. We're flying the airplane. You're not going to check us, okay? Trust us. You know, we're more trusted than you, you moron, that took a three-day course. And so now they had to back off. But they wouldn't let us have our national strike. No, 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 no. They turned it off and just said, go on through. People said, the airports are incredible. You just walk right through. Wow, it's like 1985. It's so wonderful. We even had more hijackers back then that were actually real Arab hijackers. You know, the whole 9/11 thing is as funny as a Bill Clinton dollar bill. All right. Second hour is coming up with all of our other guests. Third hour, I'll get back into all the stuff I haven't covered yet. There's just so much, obviously, to get to. Briefly, speaking of storable foods, we ended about a week ago the 30 to 40% off all the high-quality storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. But I said the four top sellers, the four-week, the three-month, the six-month, the year, you can do different packages, different spectrums of those four, those are still 30 to 40% off. It was supposed to end yesterday. The little elves that run the shopping cart didn't do that this morning. That's fine. I just extend it one day, but it is over tomorrow morning. Over. It's still a great deal. InfoWars Select, InfoWarsStore.com, even if you buy it tomorrow. And the profit we make, you know, if you want to help us fund the operation, just buy it tomorrow. It costs a little more. Well, quite frankly, a lot more, but it's still a great deal. But InfoWarsStore.com. Also, Supermail Vitality has been sold out for several weeks. It'll still be sold out, I'm told, till a week or two. We're hoping to get more. because they're cold-pressed herbs. We have the dry herb base, basically the same formula, very similar, but at close to half the price. But it's a bigger dose. And I quite frankly think this kicks me in the pants just as good. I mean, this is amazing stuff as the Super Male. Super Male has a few other effects. It's the highbrow version, but Anthroplex is excellent. It goes great with Super Male or Super Female, but it's 15% off for only 40 hours. I don't know why they said 42 hours only, but I guess that's when it ends. Get Anthroplex, is how it's programmed in the computer. 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com for 42 hours only. Get Anthroplex 15% off at InfoWars Life. Anthroplex is the twice daily pill formulation for men, it works on women too, that is designed to restore your masculine foundation. Anthroplex works by using key ingredients that you have been asking for. And it goes through horny goat, weed, zinc, orotate, and a newly blended, balanced blend of organic herbs. It's a whole bunch of them. I'm not going to list them all. Anthroplex was created to help fight back against the estrogen mimickers, all the garbage that's out there. This is the perfect product to pair with Super Male Vitality. InfoWarsLife.com, 15% off for 42 hours.
The elves that run the shopping cart inform me that it's a typo. It's only 24 hours.
Oh, the elves? Are you on air, CJ?
Yes.
Good. I love it when you come on air so they don't think I'm talking to myself. So the elves made a mistake, which they always do, which is fine. It's kind of cute how there's always typos. I like them. But they're a great crew. I think because of spell checkers, though. Myself included, I send stuff out with typos all over it. I see mainstream newspapers that have more typos than we do. It's like a... It's crazy, but the... More like minions in the shopping cart. I'm joking. The problem
minions
is...
Minions all look the same. They're different.
A lot of my crew is like minions from the Minions movie, but I'm like a minion too. I'm just the head minion. I'm crazier than they are. So it's okay. I like the minions. Get 30 to 40% off best-selling InfoWars Select herbal food, and the minions are back there loading it up, ready to ship it out to you right now. Vitamin Mineral Fusion is incredible, and it's back in stock after being sold out for 2 months. It is incredible. All the vitamins, all the different amino acids and the minerals together, plant-derived, absorbed in the body, totally delicious, totally natural. Check it out. It's got huge 4.8-star reviews. InfoWarsLife.com. That is available as well. And get the free newsletter daily with big discounts in it as well, and videos and articles. Sign up at InfoWars.com/newsletter and get free shipping on all orders, $50 or more, and get auto-ship. Get 10% off InfoWarsStore.com. Oh, I want to go home and get out a big oil paint and canvas, get out in the backyard, crack a cold one, but I don't have time to do that. We are here fighting the tyrants right now, ladies and gentlemen, and yeah, I'm in a good mood today. I went to sleep at 8:30 last night, and I slept in to 7 o'clock this morning, and it was good. I didn't wake up till that alarm clock went off, and I need to get 9, 10 hours sleep more often. I just feel like a bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. And I'm just decided to not let these globalists get me down. I'm just going to be real cynical and real nasty. And I'm going to go after Hollywood. I'm going to go after George Clooney. I mean, these people are the biggest hypocrites I have ever seen. And Saturday I was watching a video Paul Watson did called F George Clooney. And just the spirit of Paul Watson infected me. Just to be just aggressive and bulldog-like, just snapping at them. Because Bono and all these people, Matt Damon and George Clooney, reading off their notes and teleprompters, are the slimiest political dirtbags the planet has ever seen. In fact, cue this back up to start his video. I want to play it from the very start in a moment, please. Thank you. Where he sits there, and he can't even get out his Donald Trump line. Because he has nothing in him. He's a total stuff. I know people that know him. They say he knows it's all fake. It's all a joke. Matt Damon, Ben Affleck, all of them, they literally know it's all a sick joke. And they get all the big roles and all the big money by the political class to go out and spew BS. And Angelina Jolie is a UN spokeswoman. Look how happy she looks. She looks like an anorexic ringwraith. She looks uglier than Gollum. Serving the devil isn't too good for you, is it? And I just, these people, he wants everybody to take refugees and pay for it, but he has giant palaces all over Europe and won't house any refugees. But he wants poor Germans to be thrown out of Section 8 housing, old people, to make way for a bunch of jihadis. And then he has the nerve to say, because Donald Trump doesn't like women, he doesn't like Muslims because he doesn't like women. I love how they totally twist reality. It's the majority Muslim groups that treat women worse than dogs. Immoral high ground, fake. And I agree with Watson. It's not all the lies that come out of his mouth. It's the foppish arrogance and the one foppish con thing he does of confidence. It's all acting. Play it.
There's not going to be a President Donald Trump. That's not going to happen. And it's not going to happen because we're not going to be used. Fear is not going to be something that we're going to—that's going to be what drives our country. We're not going to be scared of Muslims or immigrants.
You have to look down his paper.
You know, women.
The worst thing about George Clooney isn't the unremitting bullshit that streams out of his mouth. It's the way he always acts as if he's got the moral high ground. You don't have the moral high ground.
Stop right there. Probably watch this video 5 times this weekend. I just love Paul Watson. Oh, God, I love him. God, thank you for Paul Watson. I had to threaten to cut his pay 5 years ago. I said, you're going on air. And I sent him the map to put behind him. I got him booked on radio shows, TV shows. I'm like Darth Sidious, and he's Darth. And I'm just like, do what must be done, Lord Vader. Show no mercy. We have to do what must be done. We have to get aggressive with these globalists, call them out on their total frauds. Not debate them on whatever their false pretense is. The TSA isn't having giant lines across the country, 4 hours long, flights canceled by the hundreds. By accident, they're doing it to get funding. They're doing it to massively expand their operations into bus stations, train terminals, and highways. That's admitted. And the dumb media isn't dumb. They know their job is to basically cover up. They can complain about the crisis so the TSA gets more money. It's okay to have CBS News nightmarish lines continue at airport security checkpoints. Because then the answer is give us more money, as they were doing last week. That's why our own Allie was there visiting family this weekend and didn't get back last night. 4 hour wait, got her flight canceled because no one could get to the planes and had to fly out this morning. Big lines this morning, all over different areas of the country. And the TSA, she said, was just laughing, you know. And it was in the news. They said, it's the people's fault. You don't have your stuff ready. It takes you time to take your shoes off and your belt off like you're going into a Nazi gas chamber. All vulnerable. How about we all get naked and just walk into them? This is all to break our will. Remember, remember, remember. But they've stolen our basic liberties in the name of security and given us more enslavement and insecurity in its place. Remember. Remember what we warned you about and are now witnessing. As it expands, and remember, we should have one of our crew do it. Don't have enough writers. We're just overtaxed here. But all the other people that listen, Breitbart, somebody, do a story. Remember 5 years ago when they just turned the scanners off for a week? Because they know there's no real threat. They let random people through. They let the illegals in front of me years ago just get through with no ID. They called for a special person to speak to them in Spanish. I could tell they were illegals in little cowboy hats, their outfits, you know, a Mexican flag on their briefcase or their bag. Just let them through. It's not that I'm against the little farmers from Mexico up here visiting somebody in Texas or other cities I saw it happening, but I've got to go through it. I'm treated like I'm bad. They already have my driver's license. They already run it through a database. There aren't even warrants out. But you got warrants, they let you still fly. They don't care. They don't want to actually call the police on you. They run a background on you to see if you're on a no-fly list or a watch list. There are 2 million people on a no-fly list last time they admitted it to Congress. That was 8 years ago. We don't even know now. Some secret list. No one knows how you get on a list. That's Kafka-esque, where you're on trial. They won't say what you're accused of. It's insanity. It's out of control. It's ridiculous. And it's a fraud. So what do we call this segment of the radio/TV show? We put it up on YouTube. Take the earlier clip where I talked about, we can then send this around to the media and try to educate them. Take the part where I broke it down last hour and then this hour and just say the TSA is causing long lines on purpose. The TSA is holding America hostage for more money. I mean, that's what they're doing. And then just add to the article all the New York Daily News articles and Chicago Tribune articles and LA Times articles where planes landed today and no one was checked. The customs was told they were ordered to not even look at the IDs of the inbound plane from Mexico or the inbound plane from Germany. And then they're just like, oh, we'll investigate. And it's well known that even on your worst day, you've still stopped as many terrorists as the TSA, which is zero, zero, zero. Every time there's real terrorists, the CIA orders the different agencies to, quote, stand down. I had the head of the embassy on to talk about this so they can carry out their mission. And they cover up all these refugees that are coming in that are military-age fighters that came from Syria and got kicked out by the Russians and the Syrian army and the Syrian people, so they then transit through Turkey into Europe. Because Turkey's in the EU now. Isn't that just grand? So, we've got all of that going on, and I mentioned this last hour, but I'm going to spend some more time on this thing and some other news I haven't covered yet. Donald Trump has gone too far. I heard it was going to be a bombshell all week, huge news from the New York Times, and boy was it. The big news was the media is a complete fraud and a complete joke. Donald Trump, it said that when he was not married, in between marriages, he would go up at cocktail parties and would approach high-powered women and things that were attractive and see if they want to go out on a date. And you know, that is the ultimate crime, that, you know, when you put on beauty pageants and things like that, it's so horrible. I mean, it's just horrible. And he can talk without a teleprompter or without George Clooney, who can't even say one line without a piece of paper and bumbles around like a lobotomized weasel. I mean, you can have a mannequin that looks intellectual. It doesn't have one brain cell in its head. George Clooney is a fop, a fraud, a charlatan, an empty suit, a dirtbag, a hypocrite, a fraud. You think Donald Trump's evil and hates women because he doesn't like radical Muslims. It's the radical Muslims that oppress women. George Clooney has admitted 20-man, 15-man bodyguard teams and $100 million houses here and there and all over and has all these people guarding him, but he is for banning your guns. Just like the self-propelled Jabba the Hutt on Earth. Yes, Michael Moore. I mean, I've been shoved around by his bodyguards in New York when he just comes down the street. And I'm like, hey, Michael Moore. And guys start manhandling me and bump me with an elbow. He had this big Nelly bodyguard with a gun on his hip. I just rammed my elbow. It's on video right back into him. The guy went, ooh. I was like, yeah, hit me. I'm going to knock your freaking head off, punk. You want a high-powered uppercut right upside your head, you're about to get it. And you might be able to fight, but you're about to get a fight. You understand that, you freak? You parasite? Sick of you pieces of crap. With all your bodyguards and we can't have guns. And then, Bono's the worst. I'm declaring this now. I'm going to war with Bono, with George Clooney, and the rest of them. I'm coming up with memes. I'm going to expose your fraud, and I am coming after you, and so are the people of the world. Bono, for 20 years, has the giant UN official ceremonies, paid TV all over the world, huge hype stuff to hear his overhyped music. Daily Mail right there. Bono's One Foundation under fire for giving less than 1% of funds to charity. And that's after they were under criticism for giving even less than 1%, 1.2%. I mean, the guy has brought in billions over the years, and he keeps it for himself, but shares it with government people like Sarkozy and others. And they fly around in his jet with him, and then they go into Davos, and they just pack off with all these women and all this garbage and all this stolen loot. It's like Bill Clinton keeping more than half the money that's supposed to go to the black kids in Haiti, and this piece of trash keeps more than half of it for his jets and hotels and houses and foundations. And that's not when he's on Epstein, however you say it. His pedo plane, going to that pedo island, a creepy freak island, little girls, little 10-year-old, 11-year-old girls, man. And you know who's even sicker? The filthy supporters, the evil, stupid, filth of the Democratic Party that knows all this and doesn't care. They like it. They're thugs. They're crooks. And the low-level ones are just dumb and want free stuff. And they're getting less free stuff than ever. The country's falling apart, but Obama runs around and says the country's doing better than ever. Can we queue up one of those? We've got him 8 years ago saying it, last year saying it, this year. Saying the U.S. has never been better. Every metric shows we're in trouble. Bill Clinton connected to sex offender Jeffrey Epstein. Sex offender? He's a pedophile. Convicted pedophile. You know, you wonder where your 11-year-old daughter went? 12-year-old daughter disappeared too? Spider holes. Spider holes. You imagine your daughter scared in some third world island, armed guards out front, because they got armed guards. You just don't get to have guns. And then you walk, and into that room walks old Billy Boy, that skeleton ghoul with Epstein. Oh, or you're an abused youth, 9 years old, and they take you over to see the head coach, Jerry Sandusky, who had his house right by the playground at the elementary school so he could watch the children. And here comes the ghoul. Here comes the Penn State coach. And then the other head coach died right away. The guy America admired. Sure, he didn't know anything either. Sure, the school wasn't running kids to the elite, which they admit they were. Selling them, bidding them out for donors. The big donors to Penn State. Launder their money tax exempt and then get to go to parties. And then you bring in the former FBI director, an alum, to clean it all up. You wonder who wants to screw over America? Who wants to put fluoride in the water to make you brain damage? Who would come up with stuff like this? Who would have human-animal hybrids all over the U.S. gestating inside animals? MIT Magazine. Who would think of stuff like this? Who would think of creating Hitler and turning him loose? Who would set up the Soviet Union? Our frickin' government. These people. Jimmy Savile and just all of them. Look at them. And it's come out, court finds that Perino, whatever his name, Paterno, he knew. I said that back at the time, as early as 1976. Really? Really? Pedos just have a look. I don't normally judge a book by its cover, but pedos have a look. They have a lot better look after you know what, don't you? After a real man got a hold of their little pedo chicken necks and said, you want to see something scary? You want to meet a monster? You're going to meet a real monster now and close that door. Get your fist up, punk, because now you're going to face everything you don't like. They were tuning in for the first time ever and saying, what on earth is this? It's reality. It's reality, not my opinion. They admit Clinton and others are hanging around with convicted pedophiles flying to these pedo islands trying to cover it up. Washington's full of pedophiles, the Catholic Church, all these big institutions. They're covering it up. They're raping the country politically. And then the media has the nerve everywhere to go, Donald Trump once told a girlfriend she was overweight. And then the woman comes out and says, that didn't even happen. They lied. You mean they lied about nukes in Iraq? The New York Times did. They lie about this? You mean they lie? They're owned by Carlos Slim, the second richest man in the world from Mexico, who is connected to everything? You mean El Jefe El Supremo might run a newspaper and lie? Oh, come on. I mean, whoa, Donald Trump is so evil. I mean, it's a huge article just whining. I said 12 pages. I was going for memory. Let me see how many pages this actually is. I'm sorry. I think I exaggerate because a lot of times I have the number in my head. I'm sorry. I said 12 pages. It's 16 pages long. I had to sit there and read this. Well, it first came out on Friday, but I didn't get around to reading the whole thing. I read it Saturday. It's just all over the news. Top story. Dun, dun, dun. Donald Trump mean to women. He would come up when he was divorced and ask girls on dates, and then they'd go on dates with him. And then after a month of going out with him, he'd go out with somebody else, and they're angry. Dun, dun, dun. He even breathed oxygen and ate food and even had cups of coffee. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun, dun. His crime was he didn't kidnap little girls and take them to pedo islands. His crime was he didn't rape little boys like Sandusky in the locker room at high noon in front of everyone. Dun, dun, dun. His crime was he didn't launder billions of dollars of drug money like the banks owned by Berkshire Hathaway owner and commander Warren Buffett. Dun, dun, dun. Oh, have you heard? Al-Qaeda. Oh, I'm sorry, their new name, ISIS, wants to attack Bill Gates. ISIS is run by the globalists. It's meant to make him sound like a hero. Oh, the Bushes have released hundreds of pages of skull and bones documents that they wanted released. And it's nothing. Nothing was going on. John Wayne Gacy, too, released some pages. Nothing was happening. He was wearing clown outfits to give kids balloons. There were, 25-plus dead bodies of young boys he kidnapped and tortured to death. But actually, that's a conspiracy theory because the media knows you may not actually look into that. So I'll just say John Wayne Gacy did nothing. It's a famous serial killer, we don't know. Because this is what they do. They just get up there and they lie to you like you're a moron. Or they tell you the definitions of things. Like, don't say that mother or father, they may not have a mother or father. So we're going to, on the admission forms of high schools or colleges, take it out. Or don't say he or she, say she or he. Actually says that. Just like the New York Post says, Obama doesn't think rapists, armed robbers, drug dealers are criminals. I've talked about this, but it's back in the news. I should cover it more. But they have a new term, justice-involved individuals. And that's because now they've taken your rights away. Now if you join with them, they'll give you some of your rights tentatively when they want. They want to be able to expunge records federally when they want. If you play ball and go lie. We're going to expunge your record for rape. You just got to say that you sold a machine gun to Alex Jones or Matt Drudge or a pound of methamphetamine. Who knows what the baloney is? We don't lie here on The Running Man. Why, there they are, Whitman, Price, and Haddad. Their debt to society paid in full. Whitman, Price, and Haddad are dead. I thought they were the winners. He goes, they were last season's losers. Stop being naive, people. Chinese pour $110 billion into the U.S. real estate. Now, I haven't covered this yet. This is really the big story. I'm going to hit this briefly when we come back, have our guest on, and then get back into this. Our story's up on drudgereport.com. Scenes from the Venezuelan apocalypse. Countless wounded after 5,000 loot supermarket looking for food. And then people say, well, that's a Zero Hedge InfoWars posted article. We don't believe it. Here is the god of the mainstreamers. That dwindling minority of rubes, boobs, suckers, schmucks, and ding-dongs. U.S. concern grows over possible Venezuelan meltdown. Meltdown. Yes, we're running that food special one more day. 40% off InfoWars Select, InfoWarsStore.com. Am I fear-mongering? You bet. I'm buying more food. I'm concerned. I hope I'm wrong. But things are going from it being a possibility for global meltdown and collapse to a probability down the road. How bad it is what we hope. It isn't too bad. But we're definitely cruising for a bruising. Get your storable foods, InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsSelect.com picks you right to the subpage. Stay with us. We have seen the last 4 years since Benghazi. The survivors who were on the ground come out on this broadcast and others. True heroes. Not just because they went and fought 20 to 1, 30 to 1, 40 to 1, depending on the numbers in Benghazi, but because they didn't follow illegal, unconstitutional, treacherous, treasonous orders that violated their sworn oath to defend the Republic from enemies foreign and domestic, and to not follow orders to stand down for 13 hours, 8.5 hours of a firefight, while the ambassador and his people were killed. And they've gone public. It was Colonel Schaefer, like a week after it happened, came on and broke down a lot of what happened. They really chewed him out, but he still didn't get in trouble. They tried to put him in prison for exposing Stratus Ivy and Able Danger. But he made it through that. Tosh Plummer, they tried to put him in jail before. He was the guy back during Iran-Contra, famous whistleblower. Still kept his contract job with the CIA because there's a dark side and a light side. And people get burned when they tend to work with the system. They just end up killing and setting the worst up because they know you know where the bodies are buried. These criminals in the system are scared of people like Colonel Schaefer or Tosh Plumlee or the different Army and Navy SEALs folks like Tonto that we had on last week. And so the good news here is the truth is coming out. And just what Tosh Plumlee told us 4 years ago on air, he said, I remember he was saying this, and I wasn't getting it. And I think I know a lot. And he's like, it goes down to El Chapo. I've been down there at his ranch. This is where El Chapo was even caught again. And it's guns out of there being shipped over there. And it's wrong. And it's dangerous. And it ties into Fast and Furious. He's all on record. And now, a couple years later, it's in the news. 50 calibers, Fast and Furious, down to El Chapo. The guns going out to the Middle East. Guns from Fast and Furious show up in the Middle East. It's all happening. Because if they can't get our own military to ship the guns to ISIS and Al-Qaeda, they do it through Mexico. And you hear about El Chapo doing business deals in the Middle East now and threatening ISIS to cut their heads off because, you know, they're cutting into his supply lines. They'll take guns from him, just not the drugs, or guns from other Mexican cartels who, it turns out, are on the CIA payroll. That's why it's wrong to put El Chapo in jail. That guy's been working for the CIA forever. That's admitted. His number two got caught 4 years ago. Chicago Tribune, El Paso Times, in court said, I'm CIA. We need to go into closed session. I'll give you my national security codes. They had to drop the case and let him go. That's why El Chapo says, extradite me to the U.S. Now, Tosh knows all the inside baseball, super classified stuff, knows El Chapo, you name it. It's all tied together. He's with us to the end of the hour. He'll be with us a little bit more in the next hour. Then we have retired Marine Corps Colonel Matt Smith-Meck, who just retired a few years ago and has been physically attacked, death-threatened, you name it, because he learned about it because the base they were on was involved in Fast and Furious. This is a guy that runs bases. This is a guy that was the head of Camp X-Ray, the head jurist there. I mean, he's a high-powered colonel, not just some guy in supply. He's getting into this with Kent Terry, brother of Brian Terry, who's popping back in during his lunch hour. Because it isn't just about Brian Terry, God rest his soul, who had stuff hidden in his boot about how it was a cover-up. It ties into everything and Hillary Clinton and what's going on and her minion, the head of the Democratic Party, coming out saying the FBI is looking into this criminal. They say they're looking into it criminally. They say it's a security check. No, it's not. So there's a battle going on right now, folks. And I'm telling you, Hillary gets into office. She's going after all her enemies, folks. She can only fail forward. She's in so much trouble. She will be a loose cannon and will really try to take this nation down. She's crazy. She's mentally ill. That's in the news. Throws fits, attacks people, chews on the carpet. I mean, she's that bad. So Robert Tosh Plumlee, Facebook is facebook.com/Robert.Plumlee.5. Just type in Tosh Plumlee in the top links. Go to him. You talk about a hero, a patriot. He doesn't want to say this. This guy delivered arms to Fidel Castro in the late 50s when he worked for the CIA. Living legend. Living legend. I want to get him on sometime just about history and stuff that's been partially declassified. But he's got to be careful because he just, they have killed so many people for knowing one-tenth of what this guy knows. Now, obviously, he's got things in place where everything gets released if they go after him. But he said on the show many times, I'm not speaking for him, he's here to protect himself. In fact, let me just say briefly, I was on Coast to Coast AM, really tired, you know, 2, 3 in the morning last week. Talking about Vivian Kubrick, daughter of Stanley Kubrick, who was his protege, great lady. I spent 3 days with her in Dallas up there at a JFK event. She just showed up. It was her. I looked it up. She didn't give an interview in like a decade. Told me all this incredible stuff about her dad and the system, but didn't tell me everything she told me I've said. And then we lost contact with her. She went to Florida, and I just did the metaphor of Men in Black, but she just said, oh, I can't talk to you anymore. I've got people I'm dealing with, and she was just off the radar. So there's nothing else I know about that. I kind of act like there was more. I reheard the broadcast. I don't know anything else. It was like when the D.C. madam was trying to tell me stuff off air in front of Josh and John Harmon and others. I said, listen, don't tell me this. So we came back on air, and I said, anything you know, say it now, or they'll kill you. She was dead a month later. So this is serious business, folks. This isn't entertainment. It's not your normal radio or TV. This is life-changing stuff and life-threatening to a lot of folks. Now, Tosh, if anything I said was inaccurate or needs to be clarified, break in. You're the expert. But you are a hero. You don't like to have that said about you. But, you know, you're right up there with the guys in 13 hours and what they did, you know, not following orders and doing the right thing. You put yourself on the line so many times. So thank you so much for your courage and what you've done. Correct me if I'm wrong on what I said, and then just put it in a nutshell, what we're facing, the new developments.
Well, okay, Alex, thank you very much for having me back on your program. I appreciate that. You're right. The more, I wouldn't call it publicity, we can get out there But the more truth and facts and vetted information that we can get out public before the fact, so that we're aware as we go into this next election of what we're really up against. We're up against an international crime syndicate that has basically infiltrated our government at the highest levels. The gun running operation that you mentioned earlier has been an ongoing investigation for better than 7 years. When the Fast and Furious program broke, we had some very good investigative reporters. We had some very good military people. We had some very good Mexican Marinos. And we had a good task force that was gathering information. We had a good intelligence. It was not an intelligence failure in that situation. It was a political failure that let all of us guys down. I worked with the task force in Mexico in 2010, worked with the Marinos, and found out a lot about international arms shipments through the direct commercial sales program, which I've covered on your program, which you covered just a few seconds ago. And we didn't know the extent, or I didn't know the extent, of where this information was going to go to. We didn't know everything that we know now about how vast this international gun running operation was ongoing. We didn't know that the high impact weapons were being approved by the State Department to be filtered through Mexico covertly and ended up in the Middle East and Libyan bunkers and then saw in Jordan and Turkey and was actually filtered by radical groups got into radical groups' hands. Missing Stinger missiles, 400 of them. We found out later that Ambassador Stevens was attempting to buy back those missiles at $50,000 apiece. The State Department turned him down. 2 weeks later, he and the other CIA people that was at the CIA annex, contractors, were, in my case, massacred. Not in my case, but in my view, were massacred. They were set up. I don't want to ramble.
You're not rambling. Please take your time.
We took this information when along the border down here, when Fast and Furious was going. We found out about arms shipments coming across Columbus, New Mexico. It was not straw purchasers like federal government tried to tell everybody, the general public. It was a major, major international gun running that was going through ports of Columbus, New Mexico, Antelope Wells, Piedras Negras, and by the Falcon Lakes area, and Lajitas was the crossover points. The Mexican army at that point in time had arrangements made that some of those weapons would be pilfered off and given to various drug cartels and gangs. Joaquin Guzman was one of them. Carl Quintero was another. And there was a shipment would go through that area. Those weapons would be pilfered off, a percentage of them. And then other high-impact weapons ended up in the Middle East in Libyan bunkers. Some years later, after some of that had happened, and Gaddafi was killed, we CBS photographed some of the Stinger missiles in the back of Toyota trucks before ISA was really a strong fighting force. I put out at that time 11 Benghazi questions, and question number 6 was, will someday we, our American troops, be facing those American weapons on some foreign battlefield? And that is exactly where they are today. Our troops are over in Afghanistan and all in the Middle East, and they're facing fire from our weapons that were shipped through Mexico to the Middle East as far back as 2009 that I've recorded, and I've had reports that it was actually earlier than that, as far back as 2005. We attempted everything. I say we, I'm going to use the plural because there's more people than just me involved in this. We attempted to get all this information through proper channels and was flat stopped by the U.S. State Department. And I can't say it any stronger than that. Flat stopped by the U.S. State Department. We asked the Congress and the Senate to investigate this. They refused. They took information that they had received from various federal agencies that discredited a lot of military people, a lot of Border Patrol people, and a lot of people that were working very hard to bring this intelligence forward so they could be assimilated, deciphered, and investigated. Some of us got a little bit upset about that. I went on a raid to put tracking devices on trucks here down in near the border town in Columbus, New Mexico. I was stopped from going across the border. This is all recorded in SalemNews.com and Narco News by Bill Conroy, a good friend of mine. And I was warned that if I continued to go across the border without going through a proper checkpoint, that I would be arrested. I was later contacted by the Trey Gowdy's office, allegedly. Got a phone call. They were going to do two or three things to me. They were going to issue a subpoena to me if I would not come back and talk to them. I told them I'd come back and talk to them as soon as that lady would come back and talk to them and raise her right hand, and I'd stand side by side with her, and I'd raise my right hand, and I'd tell them what they wanted to know. I classified myself as an investigative journalist reporter, and I told them I would not divulge my military sources that were engaged with NATO forces in the Middle in Europe. So, I don't want to ramble here, but they're giving you a little bit of background on that. One of the meetings that we had in 2010, 6 months, or 2011 rather, 6 months after Brian Terry was ambushed and killed in Peck Canyon in Arizona, we sat down with a credentialed person that was with the Pentagon, and we detailed through a series of meetings with all Border Patrol sectors of this area down in here in South New Mexico, as far as Fabens and El Paso and Columbus, New Mexico, all the way down to Falcon Lakes and Piedras Negras and Eagle Pass. So we had a meeting. This was set up on the weekend of July of 2011, I believe it was. Yes, it was 6 months after Brian Terry. Brian Terry was killed December, I think it was the 10th of 2010, a few days before Christmas. We detailed exactly what our investigation had. We tried every way in the world to get the congressional committees that were formed at that time to look into what information that we, seven of us, had found from the task force out of Fort Bliss, Texas. They refused and went hell-bent on trying to discredit me, Brian Terry, and any of the others that had got this information. Brian Terry, I didn't know who the Border Patrol, okay, let me back up. I was told at the time that I talked to the Border Patrol here in Santa Teresa, Texas, or, right here in New Mexico, I was told that there was, I was asked, did I know who the Border Patrol agent was that was investigating what we were talking about? And I'd always check in down there at Santa Teresa before I went along the border because I didn't want to shake up the Border Patrol down there with a civilian roaming around, sitting on a fence, taking pictures, especially at a ranch that later got raided, who allegedly, I don't know this for a fact, but allegedly a large quantity of guns and ammunition was taken from that ranch. The Mexican Marinos at the fence that day, which I took photographs of us shaking hands with the Mexican Marinos across the iron fence there in east of Columbus, New Mexico. They said, I asked them, I said, what did you find? And they said, well, we're not at liberty to discuss that. He says, but we had a good day. They had a very bad day. And that was the extent of it. And the helicopters, the Marinos got in the helicopters and left the scene. Six Border Patrol trucks at that point left the scene. We later had a meeting and that in Las Cruces, New Mexico, on the weekend of the 4th of July, called a special meeting when six area representatives, intelligence sectors, met with us and also a credentialed Pentagon source not official from the Pentagon, let me clarify that, but a credentialed source. And we sat down and went through detail, names, dates, times, pictures, and everything with the Border Patrol from the sectors.
Stay right there, because it sounds like we've got to go to break, Tosh. You're saying they were trying to find out who the Border Patrol agent was, some groups, and then later that Border Patrol agent got killed. Oh, it's what the family's saying. It was a hit to take him out because he was investigating all this. Mr. Plummer's going to ride shotgun with us a little bit in the next hour, and we have the brother of Brian Terry coming on. We also have Colonel Matt Smithmeck, and all these people are just wonderful folks. They're going above and beyond their call to expose the takeover. And some people say, oh, corruption is just corruption. To the point where they publicly fund Al-Qaeda and ISIS to wipe out hundreds of thousands of Christians and overthrow governments. And our military finally said the last few years, we're not doing that. Started actually aiding the Russians behind the scenes to kill them. And I told you about that years ago with our guest, Colonel Schaefer, and many others. Now you notice, it, a few months ago, it was in New York Magazine with Pulitzer Prize winner Cy Hirsch, who came on the show. So understand that, folks. This is a total battle for these for this nation. And the very worst, these criminal networks that we're talking about are involved in the sex trade, not just of women, but children. They're involved in money laundering, weapons contracts. That's what Sabelle Edmonds of the FBI came out and said. Remember? It's all been confirmed. They're using Al-Qaeda and ISIS as a criminal network who will do anything. Because these radical Muslims believe everybody else is an animal. You can do whatever you want to somebody who is a heretic, or an infidel is the word they use. And they are the scum of the earth. And our government is publicly aiding them. It's not our government. It's a criminal group. So please support the broadcast, InfoWarsStore.com. This is revolutionary, what you're hearing. Mr. Plum, he's got the sources. He's done the investigation, got out as a contractor a few years ago, retired. And he's got the courage to go on air. So his sources, you hear him talking about him in these meetings. He's down there. This guy's going into Mexico putting trackers on trucks. The real deal. Everything he told us years ago came out exactly as he said. The best Benghazi source we've got. You are hearing stuff they don't want you to hear. So take advantage of the storable food specials in today, 40% off at Willen today. We also have big specials on Anthroplex, the male and female booster, just really high-quality herbs. That's 15% off, 24-hour flash sale. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Now, going back to Tosh, only 3 minutes till break, or 4 minutes till break, sir. Just recapping the amazing stuff you talked about in the last 15 minutes. Were you implying, because I mean, that's what his brother says, he found the notes in his boot, that people higher ups that you were warning wanted to know, who's the Border Patrol guy telling you this? Who's your source? And you didn't tell him, and then you were building up to something. But are you just coming out and saying, sure, they got rid of him because he was investigating?
Well, right. At the time, Alex, we didn't know, or I didn't know who the source was. Until Santa Teresa, the Border Patrol, one of the agents that had been working with the ATF on Fast and Furious came up to me, and he said, Tosh, he says, do you know who the mole is in the Border Patrol? I said, what do you mean, mole? And he says, well, we've got some bad people in the ATF, and we got some bad people in the Border Patrol. Now, I'm not saying that that's the true case. I'm saying that's what...
Sure, sure. We don't know who the bad people are, Tosh. Tell us who the source is.
Now, he come on up, and he said, do you know who the agent is that is investigating exactly what you're saying, what you're telling us? I said, I didn't know the Border Patrol was working on this. Now, I didn't find this out until about 2 or 3 years later. I didn't contact the Terry family because, I didn't want to embarrass them. I didn't want to make allegations that had not been vetted.
But once you heard that they figured out on their own, you've now talked to them.
Right. I've talked to them, right. I've talked to Kent, Brian's brother.
And he's thanked you on air.
Right. Okay. Now, this thing also led into other things. I want to get this in because I know you got to go to break. My time's up. This also led into the Clinton Foundation receiving millions of dollars from the Saudis on.
Yeah, you said that 4 years ago and nobody else said it. So we're going to go to break, come back, and give you the floor to talk about that. But, Tosh, it's so incredible. You deserve a Pulitzer Prize, brother, or Congressional Medal of Honor. I know you don't want it. You care about the dead guys in Benghazi. But, oh, man. Brian Terry, you, everybody, are true heroes going up against a global mafia that runs little kids, the Clinton Foundation. I mean, it is incredible. Back in 70 seconds with a true hero. So proud of Americans
Thank
like this and Texans like this.
GCN.
I tell you, folks, so many great Texans. There are so many great people in this government and in this system that have been fighting to stop total takeover of evil. One of them is Robert Tosh Plumlee. See him on Facebook at facebook.com/Robert.Plumlee.5. He'll be with us with the other guests. We can have one of the others is on Skype and phone. But Robert, you were getting into the rest of the story, what you first said here 4 years ago about the State Department and her foundation and how she could get around arms shipments to dictators. She's got $100 million from Gulf State dictators. I mean, she is literally on the payroll. You laid it all out, said that's what Fast and Furious was, tied it in. It all came out, all accurate. You are dead on. I just want listeners to know that. This is incredible. I mean, this is just amazing. We're hearing the New York Times that Donald Trump asked good-looking women out on dates when he's not married. I mean, that's big national news. He's so evil. We have a government money laundering, everything else, drug running, arms running, Border Patrol being killed to cover it up. Please continue, sir.
Okay, well, Alex, this investigation that we went on, it sort of took a life of its own. It started out as a very small deal of mom-and-pop guns going across the border, led into high-impact military weapons through the direct commercial sales going across the border, led into those weapons being pilfered by the Mexican army, given to the drug cartels, Joaquin Guzman, one of them. But also it led into the international gun running, which I emphasized for the last couple of years on my Facebook page. And we've had vetted information, and we tried to follow the money.
And by the way, you're probably the oldest living hand at international gun running. You are the name in that.
Well, that's why I call that a blessing or a curse either way. But that's why I know sort of how the program works. I told you on your program, when you have a successful program as far back as the 1950s on gun running to Fidel Castro, and that program worked covertly and was withheld from the American people, it's very easy to expand up on that program over many decades. I used to say, well, we take a program off the shelf, we dust it off a little bit, we tweak it, and then we put it back out in the field. In this case, international gun running. It's been very good. It worked through Iran-Contra. Nobody went to jail for that, even though it was a violation of the Boland Amendment. Some of us guys that began to find out that, hey, wait, we're working for an illegal operation on a special deal to filter money and profits from gun running back and using the drugs to purchase the weapons back to a criminal enterprise, which is syndicated. And that syndication had infiltrated into the highest levels of our government.
And that's the CIA and other agencies rolling out hardcore drugs to the general public and setting up the criminal syndicates to operate as the front.
We've lost a lot of good men, a lot of good Marines. Colonel Sabo was one of them that found out about those operations, and many, many people. I give credit to those people, not me. I just happen to be alive. I'm an old man, and I've lived.
Now, you've got the courage and the will, though, to be the source to put it out.
But
I'm tired of heroes like you, you know, selling themselves short. I mean, look, I know you're doing it for the right reasons, so we just appreciate you, and I want folks to recognize that, you're one in a million.
Well, mainly, the reason I'm public is to protect myself, as you said earlier in the program. Hero and all that, I mean, we're all heroes. I mean, these guys that are over there right now fighting against our U.S.-made weapons are the heroes. Brian Terry was the hero.
That's right.
His life on the line, and he tried everything he possibly could to get his supervisors and superiors, if you want to call them superiors, to look into what he had found.
He's a hero. Stay there, Tosh. God rest his soul. We'll be right back. Stay there. We've got his brother coming on. We are about to go back to Robert Tosh Plumlee, major CIA whistleblower. We also have a recently retired Marine Corps Colonel Matt Schmithmeck. And we have the brother, the surviving brother of Brian Terry, the hero Border Patrol agent that we now know was investigating Fast and Furious. He wasn't just killed by a Fast and Furious gun, reportedly. He was killed, the evidence points towards, because he was investigating the fact that the straw purchases was just a cover. There were major arms being shipped out of military bases, you name it, hand grenades, fully automatic weapons, you name it, down there. And most of it was ended up getting shipped into the Middle East for radical jihadis. And we now know what Colonel Shafer said a week after it happened here. What was very accurate from his sources that the ambassador did not want to let al-Qaeda have the 400 Stinger missiles, thousands of other surface-to-air missiles, was trying to buy them back for $50,000 a piece, and they had the security pulled on them and went in to let them be taken out by the local jihadis that were, quote, running security in Benghazi, that was the capital of the Obama NATO-backed takeover of Libya. So this is all about turning loose the Saudi Arabian proxy army worldwide. And Robert Tosh Plumbey just broke that down in the last 30 minutes. He'll be riding shotgun with us to pop in anytime he wants to add more background to this. And we have, again, Colonel Smithmeck on with us as well. I don't have time to get back into his bio. I mean, he was very high level and one of the top guys at Guantanamo Bay, one of the top jurists there and commanders, and has just been involved in, you name it, of just all sorts of very important operations. So he has a lot of courage. He's been physically attacked, threatened, you name it, over what he's doing and, you know, following what he should do. So it's a very serious situation. Matt's been physically attacked, demonized, threatened. We have Brian Terry being killed. We have Plumlee being threatened by the Justice Department and others. I've been threatened a little bit over this, but it's just par for the course. This is very serious, and it's totally illegal. And in the middle of it's Hillary Clinton with the State Department shipping weapons overseas, then she gets money into her foundation. 4 years ago, when no one talked about it, Tosh Plumlee, and he went to Fox News and everybody, they wouldn't talk to him. He came here, Narco News and others, it's out there. And now Hillary's sitting on top of political landmine. It's a very serious time. So he's got to leave us in 15 minutes or at the bottom of the hour. He's on his lunch hour. Kent Terry, I want to talk to him first, and we'll bring in the colonel, and then we will finish up also with Tosh. But first off, since you were on a month or two ago, more weapons, you know, coming up, shipped to El Chapo, CIA, CERB, just so much more news. You have Hillary in the middle of this, your brother trying to get the word out, the documents you found that he hid, that the FBI didn't find in his home. What key points would you like to make at this point about the HonorBrianTerry.com group and organization and what you're spearheading, Matt, Kent?
The Brian Terry, HonorBrianTerry.com is a foundation my sister started in honor of Brian. We give out scholarships to kids that want to go to school for criminal justice or any kind of law. And then we help with the families of fallen Border Patrol agents that get killed in the line of duty. Or anybody that's in hard times in the Border Patrol. So we try to base everything on that and then in honor of Brian.
You heard some of the facts I laid out. I mean, this stuff's really getting clear now that this was a criminal, organized crime, global operation. What can you add that's developed since the last time you were on? Where do you want to see all this go? What do you think of Hillary being right in the middle of this?
Well, you know, me and my brother-in-law figured that one out years ago that, you know, the State Department was behind all, especially Hillary, you know, being in her past. But I think Brian was on the Fast and Furious, but I don't think he knew the extent or the name of it. But like I said in that journal, there's some pages in there where he found crate full of AK-47s and was told to let go. So I think he was aware of it. I think he brought attention to his superiors and they didn't like it. Or somebody in Washington, because the union made a point to my family after Brian died that Brian wrote 3 emails regarding a situation going on at a Border Patrol. But not only that, Mr. McKenna, I've heard from Border Patrol agents that we're being my family is being lied to by the government, by the Border Patrol itself, about what really happened at night. And then, you know, just recently found out that after we found out that Brian wrote these 3 emails, Dennis Burke, which was involved in Fast and Furious, attorney out of Arizona, his computers were wiped clean out of his house. The hard drives were missing out of the one. The one was completely taken out and clean. I mean, it doesn't even power up, Hewlett Packard, nothing. And then we couldn't find the cell phone for like 4 years, and all of a sudden FBI found it in his tactical jacket last September. How many trials they had since then with these RIP crew guys, and all of a sudden they find it at the end of the trial of last September of 2015.
Isn't that convenient? How do they get so many FBI agents and ATF and people to be corrupt and just be involved in this type of stuff? I mean, this International Crime Syndicate, as Plumlee was talking about, is running kids, weapons, money, and it's taken over, and it's been shipping cocaine in since the 80s. I mean, it's just, this criminal group has got to be stopped. I mean, it's just growing like cancer.
You know, Congress and Senate got the perfect time to set laws in place to make examples out of these, and I'm surprised they're not. They haven't even started the bill or anything. Any government official that's involved in an agent's death or corruption in the government should be held accountable, should be going to prison, and they're not. What they do, they get to retire with a full pension, sit on a beach, and, you know, put it all behind them. That's their punishment. Who wouldn't want that? I mean, it's sad that the way this country's going and this administration is so corrupt. It's disgusting. The blood on their hands is just out of control.
Yeah, there have been a lot of problems in other administrations, but clearly the breadth and scope of tyranny is like triple. Even Jonathan Turley and other liberal constitutional lawyers that are prominent say it's three times worse under Obama than anything they've ever seen. And he said that a few years ago. It just gets worse and worse and worse. I mean, look at Hillary. There's a hashtag out there, handcuffs for Hillary, and it's going viral. I want to thank folks for getting that out because it links back to articles that shows her real crimes at Infowars.com and our Hillary for Prison t-shirts. But we need to start a whole other thing about Hillary Clinton above the law, or Clinton's above the law. I mean, he shouldn't call her crooked Hillary Trump. He should call her, is Hillary above the law? Above the law, Hillary. That's my question for you, Kent. I mean, she's been caught taking money from dictators, circumventing the ban on these weapons to these dictators. She's openly committing all these crimes. And it's just like, wow. I mean, even the Hill newspaper and others have said, if the Justice Department and the FBI don't move on her, they're totally discredited. I mean, the Associated Press reports mainstream media has a 6% approval rating. Where do you think this is going?
Well, you know what? I don't know where it's going. It's going in a bad shape if she gets in office, I tell you that much. But the thing is, though, you got to step back and look at Holder's situation in Fast and Furious. Look how he was, let off on that. You know, you don't hear nothing about that. And I see a repeat with Hillary Clinton. This is what I see. But, you know, it tells you, you go back a little ways, it tells you who's actually involved in this. Is the FBI involved in this with the Hillary thing? Are they? Because nothing yes. seems to be happening. I mean, just like Eric Holder, you know, they find out all these people are involved in it after the fact, and then nothing still happened. And that's sad because these American people need to wake up with Hillary.
I know this. We owe Richard Nixon an apology. He should have gotten in trouble for having 100 names with the IRS, didn't go after him. He should have gotten in trouble for breaking the psychiatrist's office of his competition. But, I mean, that is nothing compared to this. It's nothing. Nothing.
No, but, you know, the thing is, how come they can put Martha Stewart in prison for perjury, Congress and Senate? But they can't do this with these people.
They convicted Petraeus, and he has probation for having a couple documents in his home.
Yep, I think it's a lot of politicians involved in both sides of the party in this, and they don't want to rat on each other. And I think that's what it comes.
That's
down
it.
To
We're reaching the point where it's too corrupt to fail, and so we just let them take over everything, and they're God. We're going to break in a moment. I hope you stay five more minutes with us, sir. If you have to go, I understand. But let's bring in Colonel Matt Smithmeck, sir. Thank you. We're going to break in a moment. But what would you add to the new developments?
Mr. Jones, real quick, what I would say is that we have passed information on to House Oversight, names of confidential informants, weapon shipments that's about to go downrange here end of this month. And we've relayed that information. I know Kent has contacted them as well. And so far, I mean, we see no action. And again, the one domain that the government utilized to run weapons, for some reason, it seems that the congressional investigators are not inclined to want to pursue an opportunity that's kind of being laid at their feet to utilize. And, to, as we talked about last time, Mr. Elijah Ness from Fox News is involved. And to his credit, he is steadfastly, doing his due diligence in pursuing this.
Just amazing. We're about to go to break and come back and just briefly have Kent Terry have some final comments on that and then get to you, Colonel, and Tosh Plumley. Hopefully at about 40 after if you guys stay a little bit longer. But you're there. You've got the sources of the Marine Corps base. You were there, one of the commanders. You know the weapons are being prepared. People are blowing the whistle, and they're going to just ship more into Mexico to go to ISIS right in front of everybody, and even Congress knows. I mean, this is sensational.
Yes, sir. Several former ATF folks, said the caution not to trust certainly ATF leadership. So we made a point to make sure we told the Congressional Oversight Committee that is responsible for this, and they know it. So, I encourage folks who want to support Brian Terry, support the truth, I mean, with civility and so forth. But I would call House Oversight and ask them, why are they not doing what they promised the Turk
Company? Well, sir, we're going to take this video today from the last hour and edit it down to like 10 minutes. And we're going to put that out and just say Congress knows guns are still being shipped. We're going to get this out to everybody. So that's something our listeners can take action with. Kent Terry has to go in about 3 or 4 minutes back to work. He's on his lunch hour. So I'm going to skip this break. Let me finish up with him. I'm going to go back to you, Colonel, and then back to Tosh. You guys can have a roundtable discussion. You guys can have the floor because you're the experts. But just amazing, Kent, to hear this, to know this, to know everything Plumlee told us 4 years ago has all come out. And now we just have open total crime, aiding terrorists in front of us. And, I mean, what is that like for you to know that? I mean, what do you want to say to Congress?
You know, it's sickening because, you know what? You watch Hillary, she wants to ban guns in the United States, her and Obama. But here they're shipping them to other countries that are killing kids. They're killing families, mothers and fathers, you know, just like they would be over here. I mean, how can that be right? And then you got people like Gabby Gifford, you know, that's, I'm sorry about what happened to her. Now she's jumping on the Hillary bandwagon about you know, too many guns in America. But you know what? Her and her husband shoot guns as a hobby. It don't make sense to me. It's like it's almost double standards. It's good for them, but not for the American people. And it's sad the way this country is going with this, because we're going to be in a situation one time with this administration or with Hillary and if she gets president, that we're not going to be able to protect ourselves. And these people need to wake up and smell the coffee, because that's exactly what's going to happen. We're not going to be able to defend our own backyard because what they're doing.
We're being conquered. They're bringing in 5 million jihadis into Europe, most of military age men. This is an invasion. I've had a lot of high-ups tell me that. I've talked to a lot of people currently in. And it's so crazy. This is how they would take down America. The leftist with a bunch of jihadis, with a bunch of criminal drug cartels, they run the corruption. They run the organized crime. They think they're just going to blackmail us all and kill us and go after us and win. But everybody's going to be on their toes when all this goes down. We now know the battle space. They've got a serious problem. HonorBrianTerry.com. Kent, we appreciate your brother. He was a hero. We appreciate you. And we appreciate Tosh Plumlee and just everybody else and the whistleblowers that have gone through hell to do this, and the colonel who's been threatened, physically attacked, you name it. Thank you so much, Kent.
Andrew, can I say one more thing?
Yes, sir.
I talk to a lot of Border Patrol agents that work on the border in Texas and Arizona, and I'll never release their names about who I talk. But there's more than just criminal Mexicans coming across this border. We've got, like you said, radical jihadist people coming through here. We got all sorts of people that they're told to keep shut to the media about what's coming across that border. And they tell me constant. Even Cheryl Atkinson did a story a little bit on it about, you know, they're finding the Korans, they're finding, you know, all this
thousands
stuff
of other than Mexican a month, and half of those are from the Middle East.
Yes, exactly. And you know what? They're told to hush up about it. And it's sad because it's right in our backyard.
Well, I'll add this. Then the TSA has 4-hour lines and wants to grope me and put me through naked body scanners. And they swipe my ID. They know full well I have no criminal record. It's a load of bull to train us to be slaves. God bless you, Kent. Anything else?
No, that's it. I appreciate it, Andrew.
All right, thank you. Again, that's a Kent Terry. We got a lot of folks here on the line with us. We've got Colonel Matt Smithmack with us, and we also have Tosh Plumlee. Briefly, going back to Tosh, hearing this, I mean, this just makes my blood boil. And then, Colonel, pop in anytime.
Well, okay. In answer to your question, what's the cause of this? It's factual. We are dealing with an international crime syndicate that has infiltrated the highest offices of highest agencies and the highest offices of this country. They have a plan. We do not have a plan. It is not an intelligence failure. Our intelligence community is doing their job. Our politicians and our elected officials are not doing their job. As a result of them not doing their job, good agents, good military people, good women and children are losing their lives on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. This is a dog and pony show that's being given to the American people during this election phase. They're not asking the questions. What we've covered here today and what Kent has said, they're not covering that. They're not asking the questions. They have desensitized the American people to the point to where we expect what's going on. So we've been infiltrated, our Supreme Court, our highest offices of the land, the presidency. This Obama is a joke. He's not only a lame duck, but I'm not going to go off into that. I mean, whatever.
Could you call this a crime coup? This is a corruption coup.
It, I've said this. I've said it on my Facebook. This is a coup. America is being under a coup d'etat. It's been going on for gradually and escalating for the last, 5 decades. That's it. We're in a coup. We're losing our country. And those that do not come out publicly before the fact are going to get killed. Simple as that. Terry did everything he could. Colonel Sabot did everything he could. Barry Seal did everything he could. But one thing that they did not do,
go public.
They did not go public. Public would bring it down. Hastings was going public, went down. You can name them. Alex, you've had them on your show.
Hastings said days before on TV, they've taken over. It's criminals. I'm about to break it. The media must resist this takeover. This is a rebellion. He called family. I've talked to him, said the feds are after me. And his car just blows up, shoots the engine, you know, hundreds of yards down the street. And then they just go, oh, it's normal for our cars to blow up like that. It's amazing. Let's go to the colonel. Colonel, there's been development since you were on a month and a half ago. You've got the floor. What's most important in the next 5 minutes for people to know?
Mr. Jones, I'd say the most important thing is, again, we have that source that is willing to work with House Oversight. This person is talking to Mr. Lajeunesse, and also to the Hannity Show's credit, I know Kent has been talking to one of the producers on the Hannity Show.
Good, he's come on.
And they're trying to help as well, too, to help him with the email situation, trying to find out those three emails that Brian sent, and they kind of just disappeared. Matter of fact, I remember Kent telling me, I believe it was actually Representative Chaffetz, I believe himself, who talked to Kent, Terry, and said, hey, you know, we never got these emails or knew about these emails that Brian had and was sent to us. So he actually, from what Kent told me about 2.5 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago, talked to Kent himself explaining this. But
so the good news is, just like we 6 months ago were talking about Facebook censoring conservatives, that's now an investigation. You guys are starting to get some traction here.
Yes, sir. It seems, you know, it's at a glacier pace, perhaps. And perhaps, you know, there's other things going on behind the scenes that, you know, I'm not privy to. But we have passed information, as I had talked and emailed Mr. Representative Trey Gowdy, and he said, please, you know, always forward me everything you've got. So everything I've got, I'm passing on to him. You know, we know weapons are going here again. Not just rifles and hand grenades, and rifles and handguns, but we're talking laser guided munitions. We're talking RPGs, perhaps, you know, shoulder fired missiles. And these are going via air out of a location in Arizona into Mexico. And we've passed that information on to House Oversight and let them know this particular source wants to help. He's willing to help.
This is so big that I mean, I just feel overwhelmed. We're going to take this, do articles on it. It's up to the listeners to get it out. I want to have you guys, because I got Roger Stone coming on. I forgot that was happening. I apologize. I want to ask you both back up and say a week or so. This is moving so quick for just the two of you for a full hour to really brainstorm with the listeners on how we can, you know, do this. But just about a minute and a half for Tosh, a minute or so for you. Gentlemen, thank you so much for what you're doing. I know I don't normally say that over and over again, but you guys are really risking your lives, and I appreciate that for my family. So I'm doing it to a certain extent, but nothing like you guys. This is so dangerous. I can just feel it from a distance. But to Tosh, any other final points, sir?
Yeah, I want to make a point here. What got Matt and I together is the same information that he got from a separate source about the current gun running that's getting ready to happen the end of this month by aircraft coming out of Arizona, dovetailed in with the information that we had received from very sensitive sources of a military intelligence unit. And that was the reason that Matt and I got together, and wow, also Kent Terry. We have an operation that is ongoing in the future. You heard it here before the fact.
So they're fast and furious, two ISIS continuing. Whistleblowers are saying it. They're going to do it nakedly. Colonel?
Yes, sir. And I'd say, you know, as a former Marine, the most, to me, one of the most important things is to get closure for the Terry family. I mean, that Brian risked his life, put his neck out, trying to do the right thing, alerted his family that something was not right, tried to tell his superiors. And now, you know, the family still seems to be not getting the support.
That's right. Let's not let his death be in vain, because he's even superhero level if he helps end up bringing these criminals down.
Yes, sir.
Then he didn't die in vain. An incredible point, Colonel. Will both of you come back on for another hour next week to war game this?
Yes, sir. You bet.
Well, let's get you guys in on hold during the break. Find out when you can do it together. Let's do it together next week to beat the drum, get articles out more. I know our listeners are upset about this. They want to see Hillary brought to justice. This is a chink in the dragon's armor. Gentlemen, Colonel, and Tosh, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir.
I tell you, folks, this is just over-the-top historic stuff you're hearing, and it's so dangerous. I hope people realize this isn't pearls before swine. This is political death to our enemies. We've got to get it out to everybody. They're not going to let good people operate in this society anymore. And it's good people that bring them prosperity. There are a lot of sociopaths and folks that think corruption's cute. Oh, but if an old lady didn't pay her taxes, take her house, and give the illegal alien, you know, free health care. It's all just sick. It's all to prey on the nation, drive down the wages. To the big mega banks, have the Fed subsidizing cheap labor so that they can hire people for less than what they should be paid, so they can then take over the culture, take over the society. It's economic warfare. And I want to get into this after Roger Stone leaves us. We're getting him set up on Skype right now. U.S. concern grows over possible Venezuela meltdown officials. That's Reuters. We've got a detailed report from Zero Hedge on Infowars.com. It's on DrudgeReport.com. Scenes from the Venezuelan apocalypse. Countless wounded after 5,000 loot supermarket looking for food. And yes, this is a pitch right now to everyone. This is going on all over the planet. Stores in the U.S. are 24 to 48 hours, depending on which store they are, from this activity during any type of storm or earthquake. You see the, you know, snowstorm, the shelves at Walmart, the shelves at Safeway are empty in hours. Ants store food. It's now time to get prepared. It's now time to get high-quality, storable food. And we can't do that special where everything's 30, 40% off. That went for almost 2 weeks. I said we could do it through the weekend. We're doing it today, and that's it. 40% off, four-week, three-month, six-month, year supplies of food. And that's a big selection. You can also get, you know, different mix and matches for some of the specials and choose what type of meals you want. You can also call and customize it more. Toll-free number is 888-253-3139. With the full spectrum of My Patriot Supply and InfoWars Select at InfoWarsStore.com. And much of it's already discounted. It's already very affordable, high quality, the best containers. It's what I've chosen to use for my family. And the profit we make off each sale helps fund our operation and our reporters that are all over the world, all over the country. And I'll be honest with you. I absolutely know, unfortunately, in my heart, that we'll probably end up, I mean, my gut tells me we're going to end up needing storable food. That's why I don't really ever plug storable food. I've got it if you want it. I think it's smart to have. But I just have really gotten upset about the whole world event, how things are going. It just is clearly not going in a good direction, where it's a probability of really bad collapse, not just a possibility. And so we're getting Roger Stone on. Just get him on phone. If he's having audio problems with the Skype, guys, just jump right to that. I just hope that people will get ready, because the number one way they're going to control us is if we don't have storable food, is we don't have firearms, know how to use them, and if we roll over. As the tyranny gets worse, it's an opportunity for us to get out in the streets and in the media and in the culture and be heard and be the leaders that say, this is globalism, this is bad. We were the ones that warned you. We're the ones that told you about the New World Order and about the globalists and about their plans and how they were coming for the family and coming for the sovereignty. They're doing it. The globalist program is public. And I'm so frustrated about it, because it's a nightmare. It only gets worse. I mean, look at Venezuela under socialism. And they always said, we're not communists. And they went, oh, we're communist. The last few years, Hugo Chavez was alive. Now they pray to him on national TV and in the schools for the school lunch program. You pray to him, and then you get food, and they say, see, Jesus doesn't give you food, Hugo Chavez does. It's turning into North Korea. They have more oil than, you know, half the U.S. does. They have incredible culture. Venezuela used to be almost as rich as Argentina. Then they got socialist, and they got communist, and they use the poor to go, hey, let's get this person's business, that business. They take small businesses now away from people. And Hillary said a new clip we're going to play later. She's going after the small businesses. Now, yeah, are you guys still trying to get audio Skype with him? Because I just want to counterman that and say go on phone. Now, oh, the phone is dead too. Okay. And most TV places would just not talk about this. I do it because it's fun. It's all transparent. You know, like in the first hour, I'm like, Allie, why didn't you get video of that stuff in Chicago? And it's like, oh, it's her footage. It's all over the InfoWars. So that's just what we do. It's a train wreck. We have a great crew. It's live. Nobody else does this. Live 3 hours. Amazing. We love it. It's like that time we had Michael Savage on with technical difficulties. He goes, I love it. It's like growing up in New York when they had like Filipino TV on and stuff. People be, little
I'm
puppets hitting each other.
I just wanted to pop in to let you know that Roger's having an issue with his Skype system. So he's going to go to another location and join us in about 10 minutes.
Perfect. I love it. The great part is the crew now just pops in. Used to, they just pop in and I'd be talking to, imaginary people. And even the media made some little jokes that I was talking to imaginary people, thinking their viewers were so stupid they wouldn't know somebody was in my ear. See, little earpiece. And my regular listeners are like, really? People are that dumb? Mainstream media viewers, folks, have been preyed upon. Okay? And so, yes, when I tell jokes and stuff, I've got to add, that's a joke. Or they'll say it's serious. I mean, the best example is when they said that I said that Obama 5 years ago sent a tornado to Oklahoma City or 4 years ago. And I told the caller, no, I don't think they send individual tornadoes. They do have weather weapons declassified for major weather fronts. That's on Discovery Channel. The Weather Channel has documentaries about it. But MSNBC said that I said Obama sent a tornado. That's preying on your viewers that you think are chump idiots. And quite frankly, if we sit here and believe that we didn't build our businesses, and if we sit here and watch the media make a big deal about Donald Trump and women, because he, when he's divorced, he asked women out in public, where he told the girlfriend to lose some weight. She now said she didn't even say that to the New York Times. That's the big scandal? When Obama's flying around with pedophiles to pedophile islands? That's a scandal that the media is reporting on that and ignoring all the real crime. It's scary. I mean, it's scary that they can get thousands of newspapers, hundreds of TV stations, dozens of national channels to totally ignore Bill Clinton's abuse of women and his hanging out with Sandusky types. And then Donald Trump's bad. You read these articles with a straight face, and it's like satire. And sometimes at cocktail parties, he would ask a woman out and tell them they were beautiful. Dun, dun, dun. I mean, it actually says this. But it's all this, I don't like him. I'm a winner. I'm going for Hillary. I'm a woman. He's a man. See, it doesn't matter. Meh. It's crazy. Absolutely, totally over the top, redonkulous. I'm going to bring that up with Roger Stone coming on. But again, if you get back to the meltdown in Venezuela and the rest of stuff happening in the world, I would get storable food, I would get medical supplies, and I'd learn how to use a firearm. I mean, that's just bare minimum. It's like folks that don't know how to fight or know how to swim. And I get it if your parents never put you in martial arts or boxing and you don't know how to fight. And I get folks that grow up in areas where there's not a lot of swimming pools, so they don't get good at swimming or whatever. But still, it's very alien to me. But then I see rock climbers shoot up the side of a rock wall and I can barely do it. And I seem like, I get it. There's all these skills, but you just need some basic skills. And street smarts are one of them. And the American people have been taught not to have street smarts, not to have basic common sense. And just to, I told the story a little bit on the Sunday show. I went to Kirby Lane. It's like a diner that they have a bunch of in Austin, Texas. It's a nice little place, but it's, kind of blue collarish. I'm a blue-collar kind of guy. And I was there, and, half the children looked like they had autism. The other children were, like, playing on video games, including babies. I saw two Down syndrome children. And, I don't think of myself as some beautiful creature. But, the people, young people, old people, look like walking dead. You would see a healthy-looking family. There's, like, two of them in this giant restaurant just packed with people. And I was depressed. I got really freaked out yesterday because this isn't what people looked like 20 years ago, 50 years ago. I've seen the black and white films and just documentaries, crowds of people and photos, higher def black and white photos. You look at people. They look sharp. They look, they were dressed nice even though they were poor. They were serious. The language was bigger. People read more. But it's more than that. It's the fluoride and the GMO and all the additives. Wow. Look what I was like 70 pounds or more heavier. I still need to lose more weight. Another 20 pounds or so, and I'm losing it slowly. But I still like, I still hit the ice cream here and there. But, I still like a good ribeye. But man, I tell you, they have really jacked with people. And like a lot of the women had like goiters, like hanging throats, which they really had bad in the Midwest, the 20s and 30s. So they put iodine in the salt. And I can just tell these women were all iodine deficient. Just their doctors won't even tell them, hey, you got iodine deficiency. They just say, oh, your thyroid's failed, and give them drugs. I want to just say, hey, ma'am, you need to get iodine. You have those big goiters, you take it, you know, usually that's what's causing it, it goes away. You guys want to type in giant goiters and, you know, from lack of iodine? They put iodine in the water in the villages in China. They used to have big problems with that. They had cases in China where like a third of the villages were mentally retarded because of no iodine. Look it up. Well, that's happening here now, and it's just everything. They put bad fluoride in. They put, you know, no iodine. And just these people are mentally retarded walking around everywhere. And, I mean, it's just no, their doctors won't tell them. No one will tell them. Yes, I sell the highest quality iodine out there, X2. I think everybody should get it and take a couple drops up in their water every day or under the tongue. But whatever you do, go get the right type of sea salts that have iodine. I mean, if you don't notice energy and more right away, it's crazy. It's crazy. I went on iodine 3.5 years ago, and instantly oil came out of my skin. I started losing weight. I started having all this energy. I was crazed again, like when I was 20. And it's crazy. And folks, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, people look like hell. I go down to UT, it's even worse. The young people, black, white, Hispanic, Asian, they look like the dumbest, most ignorant, unhealthy, silly. And you try to talk to them, they can't even talk. I mean, it's just, whoa. You know, 90%, we want to put gun owners in forced labor camps.
I think that's a good idea. They're bad.
Because part of the dumbness is like also an evilness comes upon them. They love something horrible, for someone to be crushed. They get off on it. Like, yeah, yeah. So I'm plugging Survival Shield Nation 9 and X2. And I didn't mean to go off into a plug about that. 4.8, or is that 4.9 stars? I can't see it. I'm looking at a very far distant away. That monitor
is 4.8.
4.8, so my eyes are still that good. It used to be 2015 vision. It's 2020 now. Last time I got tested, and I feel like I'm blind. When I was a kid, I had like HD vision. I could like see ants like 30 feet away walking around the ground. It's crazy. It's crazy. I can see like nebulas and the stars at night and stuff. Like, Superman vision, not anymore. Like the doctors when I was like 10 said it was beyond 2015, but the measurements didn't go better. I'm not bragging. It's just, wow, I got some good eyeballs. Or at least I did. And they ain't there now. Part of it's under these grueling lights every day. Now, beta-carotene is something that helps with that. But at a certain point, sun damage going into the retina. Just the way of the world. I've always had perfect teeth, but, you know, I clench them at night under stress and disintegrated that one a while back. I got to get an implant or something. I just had them take the root out. There's a stub in there. There's not enough of a stub, though, to keep a crown on top of it. So the problem is my dad says, he's a dentist, my roots go all the way out and then bend out around the bottom of my jaw. He sees that maybe out of 1 out of 500 people, and they are nightmare roots is what they call them. So I get to look forward to that because it's just super hard to get them out. And if you don't, they still cause problems and infection. So it's good to have thick bones and good to have long roots, but once you go south with them, it's not fun. Okay, I'm just completely babbling here because Roger Stone's not here, but he's going to get on with us. We'll get the latest developments on that front. Let's continue here with the other news. Disagreement slowed Pentagon's plan to allow transgender service members. Dun, 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 dun. And of course, they already got them troops wearing red high-heel shoes. So just you want to jack with the country and screw it up. I mean, if people can't notice we're being sabotaged, do we have the Hillary clip where she says she's going to go after small businesses that aren't following all the little rules, make sure they get all the regulations piled on them? Because they haven't ganged up on small businesses enough, right? Since you didn't build your business, we're going to help bankrupt it. And we've got disagreements slow on Pentagon's plan to allow transgender service members. We got the arrogance of Woody Allen. I'm old. This is a quote. I'm older and dying and don't care what happens. Woody Allen says he's done hiding behind comedy. He only cares about himself. He doesn't care about the world now, he goes on to say, because it's all about him. It's very nice.
Got Hillary.
Yes, we have this hair Hitlery clip. Here it is.
Governor Beshear mentioned my likely opponent, the presumptive Republican nominee. And honestly, the things he said about the economy are just frightening. First of all, he says Americans make too much, that our wages are too high. Minimum wage shouldn't be raised, and really nobody else should either. And you think about how that could just exacerbate the sense of
look how dumb
loss
that young woman in the middle looks
in our country feel today. That no matter how hard they work, they just can't get ahead.
Look how helpless.
I want people to feel like their work is rewarded. And we're going to make sure that businesses do what they're supposed to do. We're going to crack down on a lot of the business practices.
But not on illegals.
And a lot of the attitudes that businesses are bringing to the economy, where they're not giving their workers a raise, even though they're giving their shareholders higher dividends and they're giving their CEOs bonuses.
Oh, wealth redistribution. When the big mega banks are putting her in power, all are offshore. She can't do anything. She won't do anything. It's like Obamacare. Almost everybody went to part-time because it's written to make you part-time, so you want to go on welfare. And just totally screwing everyone over. Money from Gulf War dictators, Gulf State dictators. They're doing minimum wage in California. The layoffs are all starting because people just can't afford it. But that's how they operate. They'll also manipulate, like, let's say a medium-sized company, like a factory with, say, 500 employees. And they'll see in the shareholders that they've got maybe $20 million in a slush fund. That won't run that factory for a year if the money stopped coming in. $20 million won't deal with five lawsuits. Like, you can't get a metal gas can in this country because they sued them all out of business. You can't have diving boards. You can't have playground equipment anymore because of the lawyers. But it's all these people just, I want something free. Mine, me. And you wonder why you're poor, because you're stupid. And you're being fed on, and you trust the system. And you're lazy in many cases. Now let's go ahead and go to Obama preying on these idiots, saying how great our economy is. Here is Obama.
Point number one. When you hear someone longing for the good old days, take it with a grain of salt. Take it with a grain of salt.
I should do a whole report on this.
We live in a great nation, and we are rightly proud of our history. We are beneficiaries of the labor and the grit and the courage of generations who came before. But I guess it's part of human nature.
All right, that's it. He goes on to say things are better. You know, he said we're the safest we've ever been in all this other bull. One person could work 50 years ago. You could have a car, a nice house, and go on vacations with a blue-collar job. And the debt was nothing like it is now. We were a creditor nation. Our IQs were higher. We were healthier. We looked like human beings. Don't tell me we're not in trouble, you monster. You know full well what you're doing, parasite. Better late than never with technical difficulties is Roger Stone. Roger Stone, the consummate Trump insider, the man who has given us the most deadly accurate forecasting in the last 11 months on air. Become a good friend of mine. He's going to be down here in Austin the next few weeks, be in studio with us. We've only got him for this 5 minutes. The next 5 minutes, he's got to go, but he's promised to come back on later in the week for a full report. They've thrown the kitchen sink at Trump. Why? He talked to good-looking women when he was divorced. And he once told a girlfriend, you need to lose some weight. But she said that wasn't even true today on Fox. All lies from the New York Times. The same folks that told us Saddam had a nuclear reactor hidden under a rose bush. Remember that one? And the yellow cake and the aluminum tubes. Next, they're going to tell me that the moon is made of cheese. This is incredible. Roger Stone, they're throwing everything at him. It's so pathetic. Meanwhile, it came out 2 days ago that Clinton was flying around to the pedophile island with Mr. Epstein. This is incredible. Roger Stone, tell us about that and what else is on the radar.
Alex, great to be with you. Sorry about our technological
It's okay. You're
today.
A sweetheart. You've got the floor. Go ahead.
I think what we've now seen is part and parcel of the mainstream media onslaught that they intend to unload on Trump. What's outrageous, of course, is that they will not hold Bill and Hillary Clinton to the same standard that they're now trying to hold Donald Trump to. I know Michael Barbaro with the New York Times. I know him very well. But the problem with this story is obvious. Where is the counterbalancing story about Bill Clinton's behavior with women? I mean, at worst case, and there's been a lot of denials today, but worst case, Trump is guilty of boorish behavior. He never raped anybody. He never sexually assaulted anyone. He never bit anyone. He never sent anybody to prison because they saw him use drugs, because Trump has never used drugs. When are we going to use the same standard of measurement against Bill Clinton and his accessory after the fact in every one of his sex crimes against the Clintons. On, I guess it was Friday, Alex, the Daily Beast launched a piece by Olivia Nuzzi, who I must tell you, in 30 years in American politics, almost 40, I have never met a more duplicitous or tricky or slippery, quote-unquote, journalist other than Ms. Nuzzi. She's very talented, but she's a knife artist. And she's superb at trying to pretend she's like your friend and she's sympathetic to your point of view in order to collect information. But if you saw this piece leading the Daily Beast, it eviscerates, unfairly, completely misrepresents my book, The Clintons' War on Women, a book that you can get right there at Infowars.com. This is the definitive book that Trump needs to defeat Hillary.
He must go on the offense, as you said a year ago and 11 months ago here. He said, this will be the attack. He must launch with this intel now.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question. If the mainstream media is allowed to define this issue as being about marital infidelity, or adultery, or girlfriends, or consensual sex, then the media figures, well, Clinton's had affairs, Trump's had affairs, it's a wash, Mexican standoff. The mainstream media, particularly CNN, resists a more truthful narrative, which is that Bill Clinton is a sexual predator in the Bill Cosby style, and that Hillary has intimidated, bullied, threatened his victims into silence.
And that's why they openly have you banned on CNN, MSNBC, and some other places. That's why I believe it's sabotage. You buy new computers, suddenly they work, then they suddenly don't. You see people surfing around on your computer while you're on it. They want you shut off. You're under electronic warfare. And they're going to make jokes about that. These people have been caught at Facebook censoring conservatives across the board, except for Glenn Beck.
Yeah. Amazing, isn't it? Just amazing.
Oh, that Lynn Beck is just folks, he is an operative. And I don't, and I'm not in competition with our host. I don't attack other hosts that I disagree with, like, you know, Hannity sometimes or Limbaugh, because they're not operatives. They're not. Michael Savage is a great guy, by the way. He's a patriot. But I mean, Glenn Beck is a Benedict Arnold. He is a sleeper cell. Back in 70 seconds, fourth hour with Roger Stone, David Knight coming up. Stay with us. Infowars.com. Well, they're trying to assassinate Trump's credibility in this pathetic 16-page article in the New York Times where they say once he told a girlfriend you should lose some weight. And then she went on TV this morning on Fox and said, I didn't even say that. They just lied. They're desperate. And then they had this fake lawsuit with a fake woman's name with, you know, him hanging out with the pedo. Turned out that was totally fake, as Stone said 2 weeks ago. They admit a hoax. Everything Stone's written, they're basically trying to project onto Trump, which shows me again, Stone is totally on target. I've done my research. I knew Madeline, you know, the mistress of LBJ, all the folks. I mean, I've been on this. I've interviewed all the people that Clinton raped. Stone is saying exactly what's going on, and that's why they're scared. So tell us what else is coming, what else we can do. I know you're joining us Wednesday for a full interview, Roger.
Well, we both know Stone's rules. One of my principal rules, of course, is when you can't rebut the message, destroy the messenger. That's why you see this vituperative attack on me, Alex, on you. We're kooks. We're conspiracy theorists. We're nuts. We're loony, because we believe that herbs and supplements actually affect your physical and mental performance. Boy, that really makes us kooky, doesn't it?
Oh, they had a couple of MSNBC shows about that. Yeah, that you like our nootropic.
Yeah, I mean, the point here is an obvious one, which is they're trying to discredit us, because they cannot discredit the message. If they have some evidence that Juanita Broderick or Kathleen Willey or Paula Jones or Christy Zurcher or Sandra Allen James or the dozens of other women assaulted by Bill are lying, then produce it. If you have some counter information that says that brings their accounts into doubt, then produce it. They don't. He's guilty. In the 80s, the mainstream media did a very good job of suppressing this for the Clintons. And in those days, you only had to pressure ABC, NBC, and CBS. The cable networks were in their infancy at a minimum. So today, it's much harder to get the toothpaste back in the tube, thanks to Infowars.com and Breitbart and Daily Caller and
Drudge
and all these other viable, important conservative outlets, Drudge Report, Town Hall. the truth will not be suppressed in this election. I think that's a failing strategy. And, of course, Hillary herself says, Trump can say whatever he wants. I'm just not going to address that. Well, what is she going to say when the Brodericks and the Willies and these women who were cowed last time, who were squeezed last time and intimidated?
Bullied. Is there any way?
They're going to come forward this time. That's my belief.
It's so obvious they're scared to death of you. They admit you're banned. I mean, because you're smart, you know the history, you're telling it like it is. They are scared of you. And obviously, Trump listens to a lot of your advice. He's a smart guy at the same time. He should just be going 100% stone on them right now and just hit her with everything because she's running this thing and say, look, it's your husband that settles rape cases and bites women on the lip. I come up and tell women they're good looking, you know, when I'm in between marriages and go out with women. Big deal.
Yeah, it is far more than her being an enabler. It is the fact, as I say, that she's an accessory after the fact. And it is Hillary who hires the heavy-handed private detectives who break into people's homes.
And break their legs.
Threaten their children, kill their pets, slash their tires, tell them that they're in danger, constantly tell me, did you know you're in danger?
The guy that videotaped Jennifer Flowers got his legs broken.
It is part of the Gestapo tactics used by the Clintons, and people need to recognize the truth.
That's right. I mean, you got a lot of courage. Remember the one guy in Clinton Chronicles that videotaped Bill going to Jennifer Flowers? The state police broke his legs.
They did much worse than that. They lacerated his liver, his kidney, and his spleens. They crushed his nasal passages. They dislocated both his shoulders and both his elbows, and they left him for dead.
Exactly.
Those are the tactics of Bill and Hillary Clinton. That is what they're prepared to resort to in order to grab power and wealth. But the days of repression are over. The days that these people could be silenced through threats and through violence or through just mainstream media blackouts, those days are over. The American people are going to hear the true narrative here.
Yeah, they're scared of you because you got such courage. You are a maniac for freedom. I'm so proud to know you. Roger Stone, StoneZone.com. Be with us Wednesday after you visit with folks in New York. I know you're about to go up there. Thank you so much, sir. The days of the Clintons' oppression and suppression are over. Thank you, sir.
Glad to be here.
There goes Roger Stone. David Knight is coming in out of the bullpen right now. Support the info war. We are the tip of the spear. I got one more report I'm going to hit when we come back and hand the baton to Knight. I'm a very humble person, and I'll just be honest with you. I don't seek personal power. Wealth is something that is a hassle. I mean, I have wealth to run this operation. It's very expensive, but I personally don't seek wealth myself. I don't love it. I mean, I like a car that doesn't break down. I like a decent house. I like a hot tub. It makes my muscles feel good, but I don't like the trappings and all the rest of the garbage. I don't worship it. And I don't worship establishment fame either. People are so sold out because they never got any of that fame. People think that, if they ever just got the power and the fame, then they'd be happy. I was thinking about LBJ this morning because more biographies on him are coming out with stories I heard in Austin from folks that are related to LBJ about how he would constantly pull out his member and show it to people in the press corps and people around Austin. I know people at the local TV station who heard from the previous owner about, if you are with LBJ, he would pull out he'd call you into the bathroom with him and his press corps and make like 10 reporters sit there while he sat on the commode for an hour. I remember my mother telling me about that like 30 years ago. And then it's in the news now. That's because LBJ just did this to everybody to dominate them. To dominate them. But even before he died, he apologized. He said he was wrong. He grew his hair out long, started smoking pot. And I talked to people that knew him. I'm not saying smoking pot's good. Point was, he genuinely was super depressed and said, I had it all. I'm the president. He got billions of dollars. That was back in the 60s. His company personally got $3 billion to dredge, a canal in there so they could get aircraft carriers in closer to bomb, to launch aircraft. But I was just thinking about, you get the whole world and the most powerful guy in the world and you finally realize it's not worth anything. Didn't run for office that next time. And then the heart problem started, and he died in the air being flown from his ranch to San Antonio. And I've talked to people. I mean, I know people that are his cousins. I mean, you look them up on record. They're his family. And they said that he would come in to about a year before he died and break down crying in their office. And one of these guys, my grandfather was friends with him too. I'm not going to get into it. I mean, my grandmother dated LBJ's hitman, stuff like that. But that's where she got married to my grandfather. It's just weird history. His most famous hitman, he had a lot of them. The guy was total Texas Mafia. Of course, she didn't know. But it's just wild. But, I mean, he would break down crying for his soul. I'm going to go to hell. God, I did all this bad stuff. Why did I want all this power? It didn't mean nothing. It was all about him, though, showing everybody he's in charge. Showing everybody he can be the man, runs everything. And he pretty much ran this country. The CIA, the mafia, they all did what he said. I'm only going to tell you one time, he told different mafia heads, I'm going to kill you if you don't do what I say right now. You're never going to win. I got the army right now. You'd say LBJ unified the mafia in this country. He's the kingpin. He's the Mac Daddy. I'll have those black people with the N-word voting Democrat for the next 100 years. We're going to break up their businesses and integrate and bring in all this stuff and send in the psych warriors to break up their families. We'll see how they get uppity. Go read his letters. I've talked to the folks that heard it. That's evil, folks. But at the end, he was just scared to death. All right, we're going to go to David Knight here in a moment. I wanted to just point out that thank God I was never into Hollywood that much or into famous stuff, but I still thought it was kind of cool and neat. And I got to see a bunch of it behind the scenes, high as you get. I've seen it. I've been at the top parties. I've seen it, and it's empty. It's unhappy. They're like dumb weirdos that gibber and are totally insecure. It's a nightmare. But the average person thinks, oh, if I could just be read People Magazine, or if I could just, you know, do what the government says, I'd be fulfilled. You are fulfilled. It's a beautiful world out there. There's art. There's love. There's passion. There's doing the right thing. There's being honorable. And that's what really has value. And opposing evil is what has value. And I'll tell you, I'm very proud today. Let me tell you something. It is dangerous. Jacking with the stuff about current shipments to Al-Qaeda and ISIS out of the very military base that colonel was basically the head of. And all those people that are ready to talk to Congress. And it's just people out in the open showing total crime going on and nothing happens. But I'm proud of the fact that we're starting to get some movement on this. And I'm so proud of the fact that we have another guest on saying the Clintons' reign of terror is about to come to an end. The Clintons' intimidation is about to stop. I know how much courage that takes. I am proud to be associated with that because even though my flesh gets scared a little bit, my flesh says, don't do this, don't do this. I want to be fat and happy. Just stop it, stop it, stop it. But my soul goes, yeah, that's what you do. That's where you're going. Telling you, folks, choose wisely on this life. This life goes by, but what you do stands forever. In the future of our children, even if you don't believe in the soul and the afterlife and the next level, which, of course, is real, know that it's next level for our species. And that's what you're designed to do, is be honorable and strong and not a coward. All these shuffling, half-dead people that just don't even know they're alive, just it's sad. And please support the broadcast. Buy the products. I mean, look, I don't mean to do a pitch, but I'm sitting there looking at all these women that have, like, goiters, young, old, their necks hanging down, and it's all because of lack of iodine and fluoride going in and filling it up. And no one will tell them why there's record thyroid problem and goiters and stuff all over the place. It's iodine deficiency. And, yeah, we sell high-quality, the best type for absorption that isn't toxic and have the problems. But regardless, go out and get whatever, the sea salts that have some of it or whatever. This is such a game changer. And I'm like, I ought to tell everybody. I ought to videotape all these people. I mean, people look like they've been hit with mutation rays. And a big part of it's the fluoride, the bad halogen. You don't have the good halogen. Just a plug. I want to play this clip just because we didn't get to the best part where Obama's saying, you know, our country's doing so great, the best ever. He already basically said the good times, you know, weren't back in the past. Oh, when we weren't all in massive debt, when our we didn't have autism rates, but 1 in 30,000, now 1 in 58. When the cancer rate was, what, 3,000% lower on average? When diabetes was 2,000% lower, type 2? I mean, I could go on for hours. When our illiteracy rate was the lowest in the world, now it's the highest. We're number one, everything bad now, 50 years later. Because they use the same social techniques that LBJ rolled out on the black community against everybody. And boy, they've done a good job, haven't they? They're turning us into complete idiots. Illiterate about life and honor and everything else. Let's play the clip.
The good old days weren't all that good.
Yes, there have been some stretches in our history where the economy grew much faster, or when government ran more smoothly. There were moments when, immediately after World War II, for example, or at the end of the Cold War, when the world bent more easily to our will. But those are sporadic, those moments, those episodes. In fact, by almost every measure, America is better and the world is better than it was 50 years ago or 30 years ago or even 8 years ago.
Pentagon says it's the most dangerous ever. I mean, that's just a fact. Every metric is. It's just 40 million starved to death a year. 30-something years ago, it was like 5 million. I mean, it's just everything he says is a lie. Stuff is getting worse on every front on average. And then we've got all these other clips, but I'm not going to play Trump saying he's worried about sleeper cells in the country. And they say, oh, how ridiculous. We bring in millions. It's millions, folks. I mean, they say it's $400 in all of Texas. It's like $200 per school in Austin of refugees' kids. You know, it's thousands in Austin of kids alone. Not 400. It's all secret. We don't know. They're like, how ridiculous. He said we might get hit by sleeper cells. He said there might be a thunderstorm sometime this year. It's crazy. It's insane. David, tell us what you got coming up. You've heard the broadcast today. Epic stuff has been covered here, my friend. But overall, I mean, do you concur with what I just said or absolutely, where we're going? Yeah. I just want folks to know the world has nothing to offer. The globalist system is artificial, and they get us to sell out believing this artificiality will fulfill us because it doesn't exist, and they know we'll never get it anyways. 99% of people will never cross over in the supposed luxury and garbage of Hollywood, and it's that. It's unhappy, empty garbage. You're going to find fulfillment at the end of a dock with your kids fishing, you know. You're not going to find it hanging out with these polished turds. Go ahead. Sorry.
We know, Alex, when you just played that clip from Obama, it struck out to me. It's the first time I'd heard it. He said, you know, maybe there's been times in the past when government ran smoother, when we could bend the will of the world to our will. Yeah, when you look at this guy, of course, he says by every single metric, because we're better, because every metric of this guy is about control and power and government. It's not about individual liberty. It's not about individual empowerment.
It's about control.
Exactly.
And he's got more control than ever.
Exactly. I've got a story here that I'm going to talk about. We've been at war longer with Obama, the Nobel Peace Prize winner. This is a story from the Daily Caller, than with any other American president in history. And Alex, as we're looking at this, we've now got the UN, other world powers, United States saying we need to arm the Libyan government in order to counter ISIS. That's an admission of their failure. And the fact that they turned Libya into an arms bazaar for ISIS as they were creating and arming ISIS.
Another arms bazaar to counter it, and they'll fund ISIS again and just keep it going forever like flip-flop.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And of course, today we also had the Supreme Court coming in talking about how they're not going to rule on the unconstitutional birth control mandate. So we're going to unpack that. They looked at it and said, well, is this going to, you know, they didn't want to issue an opinion as to whether or not it violated the religious freedom.
Which in a way is affirming, because I think the lower courts will go along with it. Amazing. David Knight, yeah. Infowars.com. Thank you, my friend. Go ahead and take over. And then, of course, who's hosting the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock?
I will be.
David Knight with a doubleheader today. I'm Alex Jones. I'll be back with you in 20-something hours. David Knight, take over, my friend.
All right, we're going to be right back, folks. We got a lot to talk about. We're also going to talk about Britain's exit. We've got 8 reasons from Boris Johnson as to why they should leave. And we're going to draw some parallels I think you'll find interesting. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Monday, May 16th, 2016. I'm going to talk about what's going on with Obama, our war president, as well as what's going on with Facebook, the Supreme Court. We're going to talk about Brexit and something I think we should talk about, Texit. Okay, T-E-X-I-T, Texas out. Okay, we're going to talk about the Texas secessionists. Before I get to those stories, I want to let you know that we've got a flash sale, 24-hour sale for Anthroplex, 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Anthroplex is a twice-daily pill formulation for men that's designed to restore your masculine foundation. It works by using key ingredients you've been asking for, like horny goatweed, zinc, orotate, and a newly balanced blend of organic herbs. Right now, we've got that 15% off. That's just a 24-hour sale at InfoWarsLife.com. That's Anthroplex. Okay, before we get to the story about Obama, the warmonger, the or Peace Prize winner, depending on how you look at him, whether you he got the Peace Prize before he did anything else. Now we can look at what his administration really looked like. But Kit Daniels put this title on what's going on with Facebook and Glenn Beck and the others, and I think it was spot on. Zuckerberg to meet with Beck and former Bush official. Because, you know, when people pointed out we had whistleblowers that were talking about how conservative stories were spiked, or they tried to create the narrative to insert their own stories into Facebook and to make them trend. There was also the question that was floated around, what should we do to stop Trump? And, of course, that was a key part of spiking the conservative stories. It's part of the Never Trump movement. So what does he do to dispel the rumors? You have Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook CEO, brings in the Never Trumpers to show that they're not really Never Trump. Okay, look. They've got a problem, especially Glenn Beck has got a problem. And if you remember math, okay, in real math, you can take a negative and multiply it by a negative and get a positive. But that doesn't work with opinion polls. It doesn't work when you've got these types of things happening here. It's just going to make everything more negative when you do this. Perhaps this is something that was suggested by some of Glenn Beck's CIA, former CIA employees like Buck Sexton, you know, the Operation Mockingbird people. I mean, look, Facebook and Beck are really there as part of Operation Mockingbird. I'm not going to go into what that is. If you don't know what it is, just Google it. You'll find it on Wikipedia. You'll find it everywhere. But the key thing here is one of these tweets that came out by somebody Kit Daniels pointed out, liberals responded to this and said, hey, this is a good idea. And one of them tweets out, says, the good news about Facebook taking everything over is it would kill Drudge. That's the whole point. Don't you remember a couple of years ago when the video from the Pentagon surfaced and this one lady who was there, one of the officers, stood up and asked the man who was the information officer, said, you know, nobody believes us anymore. They can get all this information on Drudge and the internet, and they just come to regard us as mindless propaganda. They don't believe the lies that we're feeding them because they've got independent media. That's why they have to have Facebook. That's why they have to have Glenn Beck's The Blaze. And that's why it's not a surprise to see these guys working together. You know, these two guys who have all these credibility issues, the two negatives coming together isn't going to give you a positive in this case, folks. And we've pointed out this many times. Now, let's talk about Obama, our warmonger president. Daily Caller did this research. They said last month, Obama officially became the first U.S. president to have been at war the longest, longer than Lyndon Johnson that Alex Jones was just talking about, longer than Abraham Lincoln, certainly longer than George W. Bush. Obama acquired the highly dubious honor May 6th. And this is a piece written by the New York Times, but I want you to hear how the New York Times covers for him. Now, they point out he's virtually certain to be the only U.S. president to spend the full 8 years presiding over combat. Now, this is a Daily Caller, and they point out that not only have we been at war for such a long time, but he's multiplied the number of wars. Okay, he inherited Iraq and Iran. Now he's taken it to seven different countries. And the Times talks about it. This is how they cover it. They say, well, you know, Obama's status as America's biggest warmonger president is, quote, an improbable legacy, given that he ran as an anti-war candidate back in 2008. They can't bring themselves to say that he's a liar and a hypocrite because, you know, they gave him the Peace Prize as he took office. And here's another guy they talked to in the New York Times. Here's his quote. Obama thinks of war as an instrument that he has to use very reluctantly. But we're waging these long, rather strange wars. We're killing lots of people. We're taking casualties ourselves. You know, remember Obama said, I'm very good at killing. You know, this is a guy who's given us seven wars. He's going to give us 8 years of war. He's given us assassinations without apology. Peace Prize winner. And they say, well, it's just the difference between being a war president and president at war. No, come on. It's not about that. And no matter how they lie, we see what's happening. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and in this segment, I want to talk about what's going on with the Brexit and how we could learn from this. And of course, what is Brexit? It's whether or not Britain is going to exit the EU. They're going to have a vote June 23rd in Britain as to whether or not they should leave the European Union. Now, Britain is not part of the euro. They still have their pound. They never gave up their currency. And now they're starting to look at what's happening in Brussels and saying, perhaps this is a monster. Perhaps this is something that we need to get away from. And, of course, we had James Cameron, who is the conservative prime minister there, started last week warmongering, okay, putting the fear of war, saying if we leave, we could have war in Europe. And when I heard that, I said, Britain fought two wars in the last century to keep from having consolidation in Europe and have that consolidation be under German hegemony. That's what is happening, what has happened with the EU, and that's by design. We talked about how the Bilderberg group was created, had their first meeting 10 years after and at the spot of the last Nazi victory of World War II, where they plotted not only a common Europe, but for the first time, a common currency, because it's the way, that's the way they hook you. It's economically, then they pull in the political aspects here. So it's not about free trade. But they use trade, they use the currency to hook people, to pull them in. And as that fails, they say, now we need a stronger political union. But they can already see a lot of problems. And I've got a clip here that I want to play from Boris Exit. He talks, Boris Johnson talking about Brexit. And he talks about eight reasons why they should leave the EU. And of course, when he talked about at the end of the week, he said the EU wants a super state just as Hitler did. He makes the same point. He says for 2,000 years of European history, we have been characterized by repeated attempts to unify Europe under a single government in order to recover the continent's lost golden age under the Romans. Spot on. Spot on. It's been Napoleon. It's been Hitler. It's been the Kaiser. Okay? Now we've got Merkel, who is Hitler or a Kaiser, if you will, in a dress or maybe a burqa or a hijab, whatever you want to call it. But it doesn't change the fundamental principle. So let's go to this clip. And as we do, I want to compare what he's talking about with Britain to what came up this last weekend at the Republican convention here in Texas. This is a story that was covered on the Drudge Report, that they came within two votes of bringing up on the convention floor to be voted on by 4,000 delegates a movement to have Texas secede from the United States. Is that a crazy idea? You know, many people think that's a crazy idea. Listen to what the president of the Texas National Movement says. He says, we want Texas to become an independent state. It's not that far-fetched an idea. This idea that people have the right of self-determination, that places like Texas can assert their right of self-determination, become independent nation states, is not that odd at all. No, it isn't. And I want to compare these two as we're going back and forth. He'll talk about Britain, and I'm going to talk about Texas. And maybe what we ought to do is maybe we ought to start it calling it the Texas exit, we ought to call it Texit. Okay, let's play what Boris Johnson says in terms of his eight reasons.
Number one, we'd have 350 million more pounds every week we could spend according to our priorities. And that includes, obviously, the NHS and other things. Number two.
Okay, hold it right there. Number one, number one. Let's hold it. Number one. 350 million pounds per week that they don't send to Brussels, they can spend as the Brits wish, using their priorities. How does it work out in Texas? Well, in 2012, Texas sent 16% of its economy to the federal government. That's $220 billion. Only California pays more in taxes. We get back $139 billion if you exclude things like retirement benefits and wages of federal employees who are in Texas. But, of course, those retirement benefits would still flow to us, like Social Security. People can go to Central American countries, and they can still get their Social Security. So I would think they'd still be able to get that. But let's just exclude that for right now. Okay, so what is the net of that? Well, it's about three times what Britain sends to the EU. $1.5 billion per week Texans send to Washington. And that would be if we left the Union. That would be money we could spend on Texas priorities. And that doesn't even count the lunch money that Obama says he's going to withhold from our poor children if we don't send boys into the girls' bathrooms and the girls' showers. Let's run with reason number two.
We'd be able to take back control of our borders and stop the huge pressure of immigration on public services. Number three.
Okay, hold it right there. Take back control of our borders. You mean we wouldn't send law enforcement officers who try to control our borders to jail, like they're trying to send Sheriff Arpaio to jail? You mean we would have a situation, he talks about taking off the huge pressure of immigration on public services. In America, we are giving welfare benefits to illegal aliens that are greater than what we're paying people who have paid into Social Security their entire life. We're giving in-state tuition to illegal aliens that people who have lived in America and paid taxes all their lives don't get. And of course, that doesn't even address the security issues, okay? And it doesn't address the fact that we're not going to be able to afford our homes if we have to provide free education to anyone who comes here from any country and educate them in the language of their choice. Let's go to reason number three.
We'd be taking back control of our democracy, so we'd be able to set our own laws. You would be endlessly the prisoner of 2,500 new regulations coming every year from Brussels, which cost British business about £600 million per year.
Okay, hold it right there. Okay, number three for the Brexit, and here's the reasons for Texas, okay? For the Brexit, he says that they're getting 2,500 new EU regulations a year. Wouldn't it be great if we didn't have to deal with that in Britain, says Boris Johnson. Well, what about in Texas, okay? What about all the states in America? We're getting 80,000, not 2,500 new regulations from the EU. We're getting 80,000 pages of new regulations from the federal bureaucracy, these little empires that grow their empires by extending their tentacles into our lives and controlling the most minute details of it in every way possible. Let's go to number four.
We would be able to do free trade deals with the rest of the world, and that includes India, China, Australia, New Zealand, even America. We can't do a free trade deal with America because we're currently members of the EU.
Hold it right there. Now, he got a lot of flack. They pulled out the point that he made about Obama and the bust of Churchill. His point that they never talked about was the fact that when Obama says, we're going to put you at the end of the line if you get out of the EU, he says, we don't have any ability to do trade deals with America as it is. Those are determined by Brussels. They're not determined in London. That was his point. So he says, yeah, we'd be able to do free trade deals with all these different nations, even with America, which they can't do right now because they got to worry about how the French are going to triangulate things so they get their cheese protected or whatever. It's too many different issues there. But our issue is even worse because we have this deal, and of course the people in Europe do as well, the Transatlantic Partnership, but we get it double barrels. We get the Transatlantic and the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Both of these deals written by unelected officials, they're not even officials, they're corporate lobbyists. Written by these multinational corporations as they partner to manage our economy without any input from us because we are not stakeholders. So, yeah, we would be able to manage our own economy and determine what our trade was going to be. Do the deal with the people's elected officials. Let's go to reason number five.
We would be able to get out from under the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice, which is increasingly arbitrating in questions over which we never thought it would have any power, like human rights, asylum, the right of the child.
Hold it right there. They'd be able to get out from underneath the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice. And Boris Johnson said it's increasingly arbitrating in questions we never thought it would have any power over. Things like human rights, asylum, the rights of children. Does that sound like our Supreme Court? I mean, just today, we've got the Supreme Court coming out and saying that they're going to force nuns to buy abortion insurance. This is the kind of unconstitutional, illegal power that the Supreme Court has usurped over our economy. And of course, we're seeing this in every different kind of aspect. Things that they are explicitly prohibited from doing in our Constitution, the Supreme Court is now doing. And of course, when we look at this whole situation with Obamacare, it came up to the Supreme Court in the first place. And people said, many state governments took it to the Supreme Court, said, you have no right to force us to buy anything. And he had Roberts, who wrote both the agreeing and the dissenting opinion on this. First, he said, yeah, you can't do it because it's a mandate. But then he said, no, you can do it because it's a tax. Really? Can the federal government, does it have the power in the Constitution to directly tax us? If it did, then why did we need to have an amendment to give them the power to do that? The 16th Amendment for the income tax. And I understand a lot of people don't believe that was passed legitimately beyond that issue. They said they needed an amendment to get an income tax. And they passed one, just as they did to prohibit alcohol. And now they can prohibit anything that they wish without any constitutional authority. Now they can tax us directly without any constitutional authority. And now they can mandate that we buy these issues even when it violates the First Amendment directly, violates our religious freedom. So, yeah, they've got a European Court of Justice. It's going to become as bad as our Supreme Court. And our Supreme Court is going to continue to get worse. Let's go to the sixth reason for Britain to get out, and I'll give you the sixth reason for Texas to get out. Let's go.
If we stay in, they will continue to drag us ever further towards a federal structure in which the UK should frankly have no part in supporting the euro. Number seven.
Yeah, keep going on that because we're about to run out of time for a report I want to run. Go on to number seven.
All the countries that have done really well in the OECD over the last few years have actually been outside the single market. We'd be able to export to the single market without being subject to its rules and regulations, which, as I say, are very expensive. Number eight.
Hold it right there. Hold it right there. All right, let's talk about six and seven. He says they're going to drag us even farther into a federal structure in which the UK should frankly have no part in supporting. And that's also the euro. He talks about that because they're not in the euro. So, of course, we understand that this federal bureaucracy continues to drag us ever further into this empire building. And, of course, at the center of all this is this private corporation that rigs our economy with interest rates, creates booms and busts with a fiat currency that they have, withholding or easing credit. We don't want to be a part of that. And then let's go to number eight. We'll finish up this real quickly.
We'd be believing in Britain again. We'd be able to take back control and do things our way. And it would be, I think, a galvanizing thing for British democracy.
Okay, let's hold it right there. Let's hold it right there. So it's fundamentally, we'd be believing in Britain. We'd be able to take back control, do things our way. I think it would be a galvanizing thing for the British democracy and for our economy. You know what? Absolutely. You know, Samuel Adams said, if you love wealth greater than liberty, if you love the tranquility of servitude greater than the animating contest for freedom, go home from us in peace. We seek not your counsel nor your arms. Crouch down and lick the hand that feeds you, and may posterity forget that we were ever your countrymen. And you know what? Sorry, Boris, to tie you in to a crazy Texas secessionist like me. But if they won't leave us alone, we need to leave them. And it would animate Texas. It would animate any state that wants to leave the union to have government local. You know, I'm always in favor of local government. I was in favor of Ukraine leaving Russia. I was in favor of the Crimea leaving the Ukraine. I'm in favor of Scotland leaving Britain. I'm in favor of Britain leaving the EU because we need to have governments that are closer to the people. So they don't come at the people, but they come from the people. Okay? We need local government. That's what I advocate. And we need government that protects our liberty above all else. And if we don't think that we could do this, if we think that, if we don't understand the point of 1776 was to protect our liberty, it was to say that if government doesn't protect our liberties, then we are going to alter or abolish that government. They were concerned that government would be too concentrated. They had 2.5 million people in 1776. We've got 26 million people in Texas alone. Maybe Texas needs to be subdivided after we secede. But the bottom line is, it's far too concentrated. Now, I won't even talk about the debate because this is going to be, you know, we've got Cameron doesn't want to debate Boris Johnson for obvious reasons. But he says, well, I'll debate Nigel Farage. Oh, really? Don't throw me in that briar patch, okay? That's what he's going to find out when he debates Nigel Farage. I want to play a report for you now about how Obama is stealing millions of acres by executive order. I did this with Rob Jacobson.
Family. And this particular time, sons of Cliven Bundy, who's where he should be. He's, as we speak, he's in jail. Ammon and Ryan Bundy are in jail. They were two of the participants in the unlawful takeover.
On April the 7th, 2016, Nevada Senator Harry Reid stood on the Senate floor and continued his bid for the federal government to grab more land than Americans have been using for generations. As usual, Reid uses typical cheap tactics and vague snapshots to pull at the heartstrings of those who are listening without providing facts or substance to back up the claims that he makes.
Take, for example, a stunning little beautiful place called Gold Butte, where Cliven Bundy illegally grazed his cattle for decades. Because of the trouble caused by the Bundys and their pals, The federal employees tasked with safeguarding these antiquities have been prevented from doing their jobs.
But what is at stake? Millions of acres of state-run land and the lives of several patriots, one of whom has already been executed in cold blood.
Hey, we're here. Go ahead, shoot me. Damn, stay down. Stay down. Stay down. Stay down. Stay down.
Harry Reid says the Red Butte must be saved. And to do it, Reid is urging Obama to use the Antiquities Act of 1906, which gives the president unilateral power to create a national monument with the stroke of his pen. It's a very different process from creating a national park. And that's because it was designed for a different purpose. The Antiquities Act of 1906 was signed into law by President Theodore Roosevelt in 1906. It was intended for the protection of objects of historic and scientific interest, such as Native American land and artifacts. Devil's Tower in Wyoming was America's first national monument, and its boundary enclosed an area of less than 2 acres. But the Roosevelts, both Teddy and later FDR, continued to set an example by preserving monuments which altogether totaled approximately 4.5 million acres. Laws which are inherently unconstitutional are easily expanded and abused. For example, the federal income tax started as only a 1% tax, with 99% of the people paying zero income tax. The Antiquities Act has now likewise metastasized like a cancer, and it's being used by presidents to get around Congress to declare large swaths of land to be federally protected and under the jurisdiction of the Bureau of Land Management. Recently, presidents like Bill Clinton, Jimmy Carter, and Barack Obama have used this act to declare millions of acres of American land as national monuments. Not since the Roosevelts themselves have such...
Okay, we're out of time on this. We're going to play the rest of that report. We're going to premiere that tonight on the nightly news. And, of course, you'll be able to eventually find it on YouTube. It's a very important report for you to understand what is going on with land use issues. And we're going to continue with this theme when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In this last segment, I want to continue with what we began that report with. And of course, you can see the rest of that report tonight on the nightly news. It's a report I put together with Rob Jacobson, and we were talking about Obama using executive orders to take millions of acres all over the United States. What is behind that? I'm going to tell you in just a moment. Of course, many of you already know what's behind that. Before we get to that, I just want to remind you that we have a sale today, 24-hour only sale, Anthroplex, 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com. That's a twice-daily pill formulation for men designed to restore your masculine foundation. It works as a perfect product pair to super male vitality. They work together synergistically. And again, that's 15% off for just the next 24 hours for Anthroplex. Also, we still have the giant sale, 30 to 40% off of InfoWars Select Storable Food for just now. It's only for our best-selling products. We had to pull that back. It was on all of the select storable food. Now it's on just the best-selling ones, and I'm not sure how much longer that's going to last, but you can get 30 to 40% off now on the best-selling products you can see as they're showing there on the screen. These are products that have a shelf life of 25 years, made in the USA, no GMO, the best packaging you're going to find on storable foods, and we still have a lot of the most popular ones, 30 to 40% off still. Now, as we were talking in that last segment about what's going on with Obama using the monument law to go through and take massive millions of acres without having to run it through Congress to make a to not make a park. And as we're going to talk to you tonight, if you watch that report, you'll see just how they have treated some of the monument lands. You think they're safe? I'm going to tell you about what happened in Arizona. They do not protect the lands. They're not good stewards of the land. Just as we know in China and other places, we see that the government, when it has complete control over the land, is not a good steward. Not like the people who depend on it for their livelihood. But what is happening in America? We've got an amazing story that came out the middle of last week. I talked about it a little bit yesterday. This is a guy who works with the Council on Foreign Relations. He wrote an article for the New York Times last month. This is a story from the New American. The guy's name is Parag Khanna. He is a self-styled leading globalist strategist. And he says, the problem with America is that we have these things called states. We got 50 of them. And of course, I think, like I said in the last segment, I think maybe they just need 49. You know, let Texas go, or at least if anybody else wants to go, I'll support you on that right to do that. We need a Texit, not just a Brexit. But anyway, this is what he has to say. He says, unfortunately, American policy making remains wedded to an antiquated political structure of 50 distinct states. So what does he want? Well, it is full-on Agenda 21, folks. He wants regional urban centers that we've been telling you about for so long. But, of course, that was just a conspiracy theory, wasn't it? He says there's now seven distinct super regions defined by common economics and demographics like the Pacific Coast, the Great Lakes, and then within these, in addition to America's main metro hubs, we find new urban archipelagos. Okay, this is pure UN Agenda 21. Now, of course, the North American Union, the same newspaper, the New York Times, told us back in 2007, there is no such thing as the North American Union. This is what they said then. If you haven't heard about the North American Union, it may be because its plotters have succeeded in keeping it secret, or more likely, it's because there is no such thing. Government officials say a continental union is out of the question. Oh, really? And yet this guy and the same paper, okay, 9 years later, says Detroit's destiny, when he's talking about Detroit and Windsor, he says we need to have not only regions within the United States, but they need to go across borders. So he talks about creating a Detroit-Windsor region. He says it seems obvious if we're brave enough to build it, a midpoint of the Chicago-Toronto corridor in an emerging North American Union. It's coming out, folks. They're talking about it. They're taking the masks off. And we'll give you more information tonight on the Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.